Yeah. Well, good morning, everyone. Sorry for that technical hiccup. Welcome to the 7th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. A brief reminder that social distancing measures are in place across the Holyrood campus. At agenda item 1 today, we have consideration of whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are we agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 is consideration of a statutory instrument on the National Bus Travel Concession Scheme for Young Persons Scotland, Amendment Order 2021. I refer members to paper number 1, and we are joined remotely by the Minister and officials this morning to discuss this statutory instrument. I welcome Graeme Day, Minister for Transport, Tom Davey, Head of Bus Strategy and Concessions Policy, Debbie Walker, Operations and Business Manager, Transport Scotland, and Dorothy Cohen, Solicitor, Scottish Government. Welcome, everyone, this morning. Thank you for joining us. And, Minister, this is the first time you have appeared before the committee, so we look forward to working with you in this session. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following the evidence session by the Minister, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider the motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. So, over to you, Minister. Thank you. It looks like we don't have the Minister online right now, so we will suspend briefly. Welcome back to the seventh meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Minister, good morning. Apologies for that brief technical interruption. This agenda item is consideration, as you know, of a statutory instrument on the National Bus Travel Concession Scheme for Young Persons Scotland, Amendment Order 2021, which is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Minister, I understand you have an opening statement on the statutory instrument, so I will pass over to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to colleagues on the committee. I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to make a few opening comments on the National Bus Concession Scheme for Young Persons Scotland Amendment Order 2021. Convener, the initial order to establish a National Bus Travel Concession Scheme for Young Persons was approved by Parliament earlier this year and came into force on the 1st of April. The draft amendment order will raise the upper age limit for travel under the scheme from age 18 and under to age 21 and under. The draft order will also amend the reimbursement terms for bus operators carrying concessionary passengers under the scheme, establishing a rate of 43.6% of the adult single fare for journeys made by under-16s and 81.2% for journeys made by 16 to 21-year-olds. Free bus travel for people under 22 years old will help strengthen our response to the climate emergency, support our green recovery by embedding sustainable travel habits in young people. If it's approved by Parliament, the order will come into force on the 12th of November this year, and we're working with our delivery partners to allow young people aged 21 and under to be able to travel under the new Young Person Scheme from 31st January 2022. I commend the order to the committee convener, and of course I'm happy to answer any questions that members might have.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that opening statement. The first question is from Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and morning to the panel and the minister presenting this morning. I wanted to ask you about how we build up towards a successful launch on the 31st of January, because obviously up to now the message has been, you know, don't use public transport during the pandemic. I think what we're going to see through the introduction of this concessionary travel is a real relaunch of bus travel in Scotland. So can I ask you how you're preparing for that? How are you getting the message out there that on the 31st of January buses are open for business, young people will be able to travel for free and enjoy the opportunities that that will bring?
It's a very fair point, Mr. Ruskell. There is a course plan around building up awareness of the scheme. The scheme's launch today is obviously the first stage in the process. I'll bring Debbie Walker in, because Debbie's in charge of the implementation of this scheme, and she can perhaps provide more detail on exactly what's happening.
Hi, thank you very much. So we have in place a marketing team with our marketing agency, who are building together the kind of graphics, the design, the package that's going to be put in place here. Work is ongoing with that at the moment, and that will kick off as you know. We're kind of working with COP26 to do a soft introduction to it, with a big kind of kickoff of that commencing in January.
Okay, thanks. Can I have
Does that help?
That's useful. Can I have another question? Great. Okay. I mean, it'd be good to see a bit more detail on that coming through. You know, when that's ready. Can I just ask you about what you see as the kind of indicator of success for this policy? What would you see, say, within the first year? What would you expect to see if this policy is a success? I'm sure it will be. And related to that, do you see this increasing the number of families, for example, using bus travel? So the focus is on under 21s, but do you think this will drive more people onto the bus, including fare-paying passengers as well?
I think that would be the ambition, because we're all in the business of trying to increase the uptake of bus travel by all age groups. This particular age group is the one that relies most heavily on public transport. And what we're trying to do here, Mr. Ruskell, is to embed bus travel as a preferred. Sorry, can you hear me still, convener?
Yes, we can.
Okay, sorry, I cut out there. Yeah, so I was saying, Mr. Ruskell, In part, this is about embedding bus travel as a preferred means of transport for this age group. In terms of success, it's a difficult project because you're right to point to the fact that we're coming through the pandemic. I think in the first instance, we won't initially see the kind of levels of usage that we ultimately are going to see. So there'll be a kind of soft period where we will undoubtedly see an uptake in usage, and we'll have to build upon that. So we have estimates, but they are guesstimates, frankly, about levels of usage. But we are confident that this is going to be a major success as a policy.
Okay, Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. I have three very quick questions, if I may. Minister, given the reimbursements for the under 22 and over 60 schemes to bus operators are significantly less than 100%, what does your modelling show could be the impact on adult fares, so the 23 to 59? Is there any risk that adult bus fares may have to increase at any point to compensate for lost revenue?
Johnny, give me your other questions. You want me to answer that one, Mr. Kerr?
If you can answer that, First Minister.
Okay, that's fine. We don't believe that to be a risk because we're working very closely with the operators, the bus operators on this scheme. The levels of reimbursement have been shaped very much on that dialogue, and we are committed to return to these numbers in due course if anything emerges that suggests that the levels of reimbursement aren't appropriate. So we don't anticipate an issue of the type that you're flagging.
Very grateful, and thanks for the clear answer, Minister. Second point, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I believe the funding for the over 60s scheme was cut in 2017. Given people seem to be working longer, particularly as we recover from the pandemic, is the intention to reverse that cut? And is there a risk that some people might feel that you've cut support for the over 60s scheme in order to pay for the under 22 scheme?
You appreciate, Mr. Kerr, that 2017 was some time before I came into post. All I can tell you is that the over 60s scheme is working effectively and efficiently. We have a very good working relationship with the bus operators, and I see all of these schemes sitting alongside each other, funding independently the various aspects of what's delivered here. So, I don't see an issue here. This is a scheme that I think is going to enhance what we have currently and certainly not have a detrimental impact on anyone else, because apart from anything else, the greater uptake of bus usage that we have, the more sustainable some of these more endangered services are.
Thank you. Finally, for me, if I may, Convener, what assurances, Minister, do the bus companies have that the ongoing £55 million subsidy costs from government to support this scheme will be sufficient, are baked in, and can't be reduced in future years? And do you know off the top of your head which budget this is going to come out of?
I think it's important to recognise the relationship between the bus operators in a variety of ways with Scottish Government and the various teams who work for us with them. This is a fully funded scheme. It will remain a fully funded scheme. It will develop in its nature as the numbers come to the fore, so as we get a bit clearer idea of how many of each age group are actually using the buses. But I can tell you that the circumstances in which this has been put together has very much been a team effort.
Thank you.
Thank you. Liam. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. I think this is very welcome. What I would like to ask today is, what is the Government's response to the Everyone Aboard campaign, which Poverty Alliance is leading? It's supported by 120 organisations, and that would expand this scheme to everyone under the age of 25 and people who are in receipt of benefits. Is that the direction of travel that the government wants to go in? And at what point will this scheme be reviewed once it comes into force next January?
Okay, we have a quite a substantially good working relationship with the Poverty Alliance on a number of transport-related issues. With regard to your specific point about extension beyond this, as Ms. Lennon will know, that the priority here is the under-22s. That's what this scheme is aimed at. But we are planning a Fair Fares review that will be taken forward in due course to look at the whole raft of bus-related and other transport-related fares and the range of discounts and concessionary schemes. So it would be wrong of me to prejudge what that review will throw up. We're aware of many asks in relation to fares across public transport. Everybody would like to see this expanded in a variety of ways. But the way to do this is to have a proper review that looks at this holistically, and then we can reflect on the findings of that review.
Thank you, Minister. And as well as the ability to access buses for free, we need to make sure that young people, in fact, everyone has access to bus services in the first place. On Friday, I joined with some of the thousands of youth climate strikers in Glasgow who are marching ahead of COP26 and who all want sustainable travel. And one issue was raised with me about a reduction in bus services. So having the free bus pass is great, but if there's no bus to get on, it's not really much use to anyone. So in terms of that holistic approach, what is government doing to make sure that communities do have proper bus services, including students, particularly those in my area where they've lost the X1 bus? But I was told on Friday by students from University West of Scotland that also that the special bus that was put on when the campus moved stopped running at 5 o'clock, and that's not much good to students in Lanarkshire. So can the Minister and the team take that away and look at that as well, please?
Ms. Lennon knows that she and I have met to discuss the X1 bus, amongst other topics, even though the X1 bus is not something that the responsibility doesn't sit with government. She also knows that I'm passionate about developing access to bus services. I think that's going to be pivotal as we respond to climate change moving forward. The specifics about individual services, as she knows, will sit with local authorities or regional transport partnerships. But if I give her the commitment that we have shown during the pandemic with the additional support that we've given to bus operators to ensure that as many services as possible, now it varies from area to area, but it's certainly north of 90% of normal services are currently running. And that I think she should take as an indication of our view about the importance of buses. If she has specific issues relating to the area in which she represents, then I would direct her to talk either to the relevant local authority or the regional transport partnership.
Thank you.
Please.
Good morning, Minister. It's basically just to ask you, the local authorities are going to be the ones that are going to be responsible for the rollout of the scheme. As I'm still a local councillor, you probably won't be surprised to hear me asking this question. But what additional support will either be needed or given to ensure that the local authorities have got the scheme ready to go when it comes into place in January 2022?
Okay, if Mr. Dunbar is content, I'll bring Debbie Walker in to give her some specifics around that, because she's dealing directly with the local authorities.
Hi, can everyone hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Thanks. We are working with our delivery partners. So our delivery partners in this are Improvement Service and NETPO, which is the National Entitlement Card Programme Office. And they manage the application process and work with the local authorities to local authorities to deliver that. Improvement Service have established a Get Your NEC, which is an online portal that the majority of the 32 local authorities have signed up to, which will hopefully take away the brunt of the kind of application process because people will be doing it online. We're also working with our delivery partners and the local authorities to make sure they're aware of what needs to happen, that they've got application processes in place, that they're ready for the launch date. And we're getting feedback from local authorities and working through that with them. And as yet, nobody has raised serious concerns because we've got the online application process, which we're anticipating the majority of people will use, and it'll just be a small percentage of the population that will need to actually go in to do face-to-face applications. So we've got procedures in place and we're working with them to make sure it's going to be as painless as possible for the local authorities.
Okay, Can I, a very quick supplementary is just to ask, and are we ensuring that that we're getting the message out there for young people to apply now, so that we're not having, you know, at the beginning of January, a huge amount of applications?
Do you want me to answer that one? Sorry. At the moment, we're not pushing that message out there. Our marketing is going to be launching in January to be to do that. We're looking at a kind of more controlled manner. We don't want people to apply for cards now because the procedures, not the procedures, the application process that we're looking to promote has not been fully tested yet. So we want to make sure the systems is tested and streamlined as possible. Everything's there, ready to go. So we're not pushing that message of applying now for your card. We would prefer people to wait to January when we've got everything in place and ready for the launch.
OK, thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. Liam Kerr to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you again, Convener. Just, Minister, because Jackie Dunbar just asked you about local authorities, I wonder if you can tell me, in the papers we've got, it's stated that if the reimbursement is too low, the bus companies may need support from a local authority. So what plans would you have to give support to what are already cash-strapped local authorities if they suddenly find themselves in a position where they have to subsidise bus companies because the reimbursement's too low?
I don't recognise that concern in the first instance, because I've explained earlier that there is a lot of engagement around the reimbursement rate, and it will be monitored very, very closely to ensure we don't get into that sort of situation. However, we are working very closely with local authorities on a variety of issues, and we will ensure that the local authorities are not in that position, because this is a scheme that is being funded through the agreed mechanisms that we have with the bus operators.
Right. It's just because your papers say the local authorities will pick up the pieces if it gets to that stage, which was the reason for my question. However, I've heard your answer, but just one final thing, Convener, if I may. Just given that the bus companies will presumably have more passengers for less revenue, what incentive do you foresee for the bus companies to add new routes, particularly in rural or outlying areas?
I think Mr. Kerr's conflating two different issues here. This is a scheme that is designed to persuade more young people to use bus services. Sitting alongside that are the provisions of the Transport Scotland Act, which will empower local authorities and regional transport partnerships to work with bus providers to develop the provision of routes. Now, there may be a degree of crossover, but they are separate things here.
No further questions, Convener.
Thanks, Liam. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you, Minister. Obviously, this policy will save young people cash. It will help support behaviour change to tackle climate change. And thirdly, it may provide sustainability for bus companies that otherwise might not have that. Now, I know the government moved rapidly at the start of the pandemic to keep bus companies afloat. I think the questions about the finances of this need a bit more detail. So in terms of ensuring that the reimbursement rate, which actually will be a symptom of success in the first two things I talked about, more young people using buses, when will you assess the delivery of this in relation to targets, and when might the committee get some report as to what that movement will be? So when are you expecting to review it?
Okay, I'll bring Tom Davey in to answer the specifics of that question.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Deputy Convener, we are committed to monitoring and evaluating the scheme. We are in the process of commissioning evaluators to undertake a baseline study, basically on what's happening before the scheme becomes operational at the end of January. We're then going to return to that in 1 year's time to see whether the scheme is working as anticipated, whether anything is happening that we were not expecting to happen. And then I think we're due to come back to it in, I think, after 3 and after 5 years. So there's a sort of a main evaluation point. First evaluation point is 1 year in, first year of operation.
I'm assuming that's the...
We'll be looking at things like...
So that's 31st January 2023?
Oh, I guess so. I'm not sure, promising it's going to be exactly on the 31st of January. They'll have to undertake field work and surveys and so on, and then write a report on that. And then that will be produced, and that will tell us how we're doing.
So, and I appreciate the Minister said that the issues of bus services are separate and distinct, but there's clearly an interrelationship between the success of young people using the bus service and the availability of bus services. So in a constituency like mine, where it's easy to travel by bus east-west, but difficult to travel by bus north-south, going back to the point of sustainability of services and many young people wanting to travel in the early evening, going back to a point Monica Lennon made, is there an opportunity here during that year, not waiting for that year, but during that year to get better alignment with local government and their provisions? Because actually that would be the sweet spot if we could not only get more young people on buses, but actually have that sustainability and improve services in particularly semi-rural and rural areas, particularly in the evening.
Yeah, and I'm not sure, Minister, if you want to, I can say a little bit on that, but...
I'd be interested in the Minister's response.
Am I audible? Yeah.
I'd be interested in the Minister's response, because he obviously can help make this happen.
I think it's a very, very good point that Fiona Hislop makes. I can see that in my own constituency as well. So there may well be a sweet spot that emerges in this. We are working with bus providers. We could look at some improvements of the type that she is referring to through the regional transport partnerships, of course. But I would just make the point to her that there will be the initial phase in this where we may not see the level of uptake that we are ultimately going to see as we come through the pandemic. So I suspect there's going to be an initial period where we won't really get a full picture of what's going to happen. And then I would expect it to take off. And you know, by that point, a year from now, we'll have a clearer idea of the opportunities that arise from this.
Thanks, Fiona. Final very brief question from Colette Stevenson.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. We've touched upon the impact or potential impact that it might have on local authorities and the regional transport partnerships. Can you or do you see any impact at all on the procurement of, you know, the frameworks for the school transport when this gets rolled out?
We recognise that there is a possibility of an impact on school transport, and that's why it's difficult to quantify at this stage, as you appreciate, and that's why we're having that close dialogue with local authorities to monitor this as we move into the rollout of the scheme. So that we are alive to it. It's a very good question, but it is one that we're engaged with local authorities on.
Okay. Obviously, within each local authority, Minister, you can understand that there will be various different frameworks and tenders, and it's how we can align that as well, because there could be a 3-year framework or a 4-year framework, and the impact of that on the private transport providers as well.
Yeah, I recognise that there could be negligible impacts in most places, but there could be significant impacts in certain other ones. So we do recognise that. I just offer the member the reassurance that in the bus space, the interaction between regional transport providers, local authorities and Transport Scotland is a significant interaction. So it is something, this dialogue goes on about all the time. So we are on top of this.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Colette. There are no more questions from members at this stage. That takes us to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M00962, calling for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to recommend approval of the draft National Bus Travel Concession Scheme for Young Persons Scotland Amendment Order 2021. I now invite the Minister to move this motion and, if he wishes, to speak further to the motion.
Intent simply to move, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. And let me ask if any members have any final questions for the Minister. Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, just to make a brief point, Convener, which is that I think this is going to be a brilliant policy. I think it's going to be transformational for young people. I've met so many young people, particularly in rural areas, who are really excluded by the price of bus travel. There is a wider issue about the quality of services, but I think having had constructive conversations with a number of bus companies, they're looking forward to this coming in. They're looking at how they improve services on the back of this. So I think, this is going to be transformational, I think, for many people in rural areas. I was also pleased to hear from the Minister about the commitment to a fair fares review as well. I think there will be a point where we need to consider wider public transport. I know there's interest in ferries, for example, about, free ferry tickets or whatever. I think considering all of this in the round is going to be important, including any, moves to extend the age limit further. But yeah, very, very welcome. And, I hope that there's a successful launch at the end of January and the publicity can get out there and the message can get out there to young people and families that free bus travel has now arrived.
Thank you, Mark. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, and perhaps after that the Minister can respond in his winding up statement.
This is a very strong policy for young people, the climate emergency, but also sustainability of buses. But I think the devil will be in the detail on the reimbursement rate, as raised by Liam Kerr and indeed Jackie DeBar as well. And I think keeping close in alignment with local authorities is going to be key in the success of this. I think Colette Stevenson raised a very important point where you have a situation, for example, with bus contracts. If you look at the individuals, where some young people can get free bus transport because of the school transport legislation, but some don't. And we have many families where people perhaps don't live together, and sometimes if they're living with one parent, they don't have access to free transport. And that obviously is going to have an implication for this policy as well. So we welcome the broad thrust of this, but I would encourage, in terms of the sustainability of bus companies themselves, but also what does this mean for individuals and how they live their lives, will be an important part in, yes, the promotion, but also in the detail in working with local authorities, not just with their transport contracts, but also with the education department. So I'd encourage the Minister to consider these things as the policy is, I hope, successfully rolled out.
Minister, would you like, there are no further contributions from members, would you like to address those issues in your summing up?
Very briefly, Convener, because I know we've taken quite a lot of time at the start because of technical problems. It has got enormous potential, this policy. It is a fantastic opportunity. But I just want to reiterate, we are alive to the risk of some unintended consequences. That's why this has been developed so closely with partners, to make sure that we avoid any negative consequences of this. But Fiona Hislop's right, she makes a number of very good points there. And obviously, Convener, in terms of the review process, we'll be happy to engage with the committee further on this, presuming that this goes forward today. And the alignment point is a very good one. As I say, we'll commit to take all of that away and include it in our thinking going forward.
Thank you very much. Minister, the question now is that motion S6M00962 in the name of the Minister for Transport be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Following this vote, the committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. I ask the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication.
Agreed.
Duly approved. That brings us to the end of this session. Let me thank the Minister once again and his colleagues for joining us this morning. I will now suspend the meeting before we hand over to another panel of witnesses. Thank you.
Minister to use my free voice.
Welcome back, everyone. The committee will now take evidence from a variety of important stakeholders. We are hearing from two panels this morning. First, we will hear from representatives of Scotland's Climate Change, Scotland's Climate Assembly, and members of the Scottish Youth Parliament's Transport, Environment and Rural Affairs Committee. I welcome our panel this morning. We have Susie Townsend, Head of Secretariat, Jocelyn Richard, Assembly Member, Katie Reid, Children's Voices Programme Manager, all at Scotland's Climate Assembly, and Liam Fowley from the Scottish Youth Parliament's Transport, Environment and Rural Affairs Committee. Good morning. We're delighted you could join us this morning, and thank you for taking time to be with us. As we have a large panel this morning, it would help broadcasting if members could indicate the panel member their questions are addressed to. And for our witnesses, broadcasting will operate your camera and microphone. There is no need for you to do anything on your side. We will now move to questions. And the first question I had, the first thing I wanted to say was thank you all very much for the tremendous amount of work you have put in this area, and for the raft of recommendations and policy ideas that you have put forward. These are enormously helpful for this committee as we look at the transition to net zero. And it's very helpful that the views and opinions that you have represented reflect a wide range of public views. The first area I wanted to explore with the panel is about the main areas of behavioural change that you think will be necessary in our journey to net zero. A lot of the recommendations that you have put forward will require behavioural change across a large number of sectors, transport, business and by consumers. And when we had the Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson before the committee a couple of weeks ago, he actually identified behavioural change as one of the greatest challenges for policymakers. So I thought it would be a good topic to bring up with this panel because you're well placed to comment on what you think behavioural change might mean in reality because you represent a wide cross-section of the public in Scotland. So with that context and brief introduction, perhaps I could start with the Climate Assembly and get your views on the main areas of behavioural change that individuals across society would be looking at. And Susie Townsend, perhaps I could start with you.
Thank you very much indeed. And firstly, thank you very much to the committee for inviting us to come before you today. Just to note that the Assembly is entirely embedded in the Scottish parliamentary process, which is quite unusual for citizens' assemblies. And so we're delighted to have the opportunity to talk further to you about the recommendations that we've made and to do it in a cross-party spirit, which we have had throughout the establishment and the operation of the Assembly. We do feel that this committee has a really important role in helping us and really acting as our champions and advocates. So very grateful to talk a little bit more about the details, both of the recommendations and the principles behind what the Assembly has suggested. And I'll let Jocelyn talk a little bit more in detail about some of the recommendations. But just to say, in terms of behaviour change, I think what really struck me as a facilitator of this process was the appetite that Assembly members had for behaviour change, that when they were provided with good evidence about what was needed across the range of activities, whether it was travel or heating homes or diets, the key things which really will have an impact on reducing emissions in Scotland, people really had an appetite to make the changes required. And I think, Jocelyn might talk about this a little bit more, but I think the very strong message that members gave was they wanted everybody in Scotland to understand the impact of activities in the way that they now did, because they felt that people of Scotland do want to make a difference. They do want to be world leaders in terms of reducing emissions, but often people don't know how to do it. And they really felt that it was important that people understood how changes they could make would make a difference. But I'll let Jocelyn reflect on that, And then maybe give Katie a chance to talk about what the children said on those issues as well. Justin.
Right, thank you, Susie. I would just like to begin. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, okay. I would just like to begin by saying that, you know, what Susie said is very, very true. I think that before I was an Assembly member, although I was aware of climate change, I really didn't appreciate the extent of how everything around me, all the choices that I make, reflect on the carbon emissions that I make into the environment. And so the first thing I would say is that I think the people in the Assembly certainly had an appetite for change once we were presented with the information. But I think that is a main thing, that the people in Scotland, first of all, need to know the situation regarding the climate emergency so that they can be aware of what the potential they have as individuals is to change our carbon footprint. There's a lot that we can do, and behavioural change is really at the basis of a lot of it. One of the things that people are unaware of is that their general consumption, how that affects our carbon footprint. So much of carbon emissions in Scotland comes from the very things we buy, the services we use, the choices we make in our daily lives of how we go about, you know, making the choices with our diet and our general consumerism. So these are things that we need to try to make people see a new norm. And one of the areas, excuse me, that behavioural change, excuse me, one of the areas that we can look at are the choices that we make with our diet. I don't think a lot of people realise the effect that their dietary choices have on our carbon footprints. So one of the things that we looked at as an Assembly were things like carbon food labelling that many Assembly members were in favour of, things that will give people the opportunity to make their own choices and change the way perhaps they eat. Other areas are transport. We had recommendations that we were looking at to develop public transport, certainly in cities, that revolved around the bus systems, making active transport more available through cycling lanes. What we recognized is that the solution to these problems are going to be very varied depending upon where you live. We have a large urban population, but we also have rural areas that are classified as accessible or inaccessible, and we are going to need different transport solutions depending on what areas we're looking at. So for cities, we are looking at an integrated, a good, very good bus service that provides services to everyone that reduces car usage. We want to promote active transport through cycle lanes, through the ability to walk to places. So that's, people are very interested in reducing our carbon emissions through transport, and also, you know, home improvements, retrofitting our homes was very important to the climate assemblies. A lot of our homes are old, they're poorly insulated, their energy, you know, they don't pass the EPC band rating of level C, you know, so this is something that also contributes to people being in fuel poverty. And eliminating fuel poverty is one of our recommendations that we really want to see come into, we want to eliminate fuel poverty. So these are some of the things that we were talking about in the Assembly.
Thanks very much, Jocelyn, and for those opening remarks. I'd like to bring in Katie Reid for her perspective, and then Liam Fowley of the Scottish Youth Parliament. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you very much for the opportunity to represent the children's perspective and the children's contribution to the Scotland Climate Assembly. Ultimately, it would be wonderful if the children could be here this morning, but due to school times, I'm going to share some of their reflections this morning with you all. Just to echo what both Susie and Jocelyn have shared about some of the kind of key points that came out of the Adult Climate Assembly element, if you like. A lot of these were really echoed by the children in the kind of parallel but very much interconnected process that we went through with the children across Scotland involved in Scotland's Climate Assembly. And I guess I just wanted to raise a few kind of key points that are summarised in the children's report, which was laid in Parliament in June. But kind of key things that came out for the children was children's recognition that not everyone in Scotland actively knows about and or cares about the climate emergency and necessarily wants to be part of the solutions. Children recognise that actually not everybody wants to be like make big changes to their lifestyle. And a lot of this comes down to knowledge and understanding of the kind of impact that their lifestyles make, but also the kind of solutions and opportunities there are and the support that's in place to support people to transition to more environmentally friendly lives. Children also describe thinking about kind of attitudes and popular trends. The experience of the children in themselves is that often they can describe wanting to ensure that they feel included and accepted by their peers. And often things like popular lifestyle trends or having the latest toys, latest fashion items, even technology can be something that really kind of acts as a barrier to children and their families by implication, being able to kind of make sustainable choices. So that feeling of feeling included and part of something can often be a barrier to that kind of shift in lifestyle changes. But I do think a lot of this, and one of the kind of key things to come out of the children's investigation, was around education. A lot of the children that were involved, and this is something that on a personal level really shocked me, was a lot of children highlighted that they had very little understanding of climate change and of the climate emergency and solutions that are available to us here in Scotland. And so like the adults who went through the Climate Assembly process, the children were learning about not only the science, but the solutions and opportunities here in Scotland. And as a result, children have gone on a huge learning journey and can now look back over the last year and reflect on just how much that they've learned and are reflecting on their individual lives. Just one child last week was sharing that as a result, he's now not littering in the playground and he's encouraging his friends not to litter when he sees them doing so. So not only are they beginning to take their own kind of individual changes in their life, they're starting to have that, you know, wider effect on the peers as well. And I think that part about the children's calls to action around learning and around education and making climate education something that is really mainstream, but also something that not just looks at kind of the curriculum element, but is something that is part of the ethos and the holistic way that children are taught in schools and in their communities is really important and definitely something that will help to inspire and motivate people to take those lifestyle choices. But this also, we have to remember that, you know, children themselves do not always have the capacity and the agency to be able to make those choices. And I wanted to just share a quote with you from one of the choices, because I think this highlights the relationship with adults and the responsibility of adults to realise children's rights when we're thinking about the climate emergency. So this is from a child age 11 from the Western Isles who was involved in the Climate Assembly. It can be very difficult for children to make environmentally choices because usually it's their parents who make them. They don't really get the choice. And also, well, you can't really just say, right, I don't like what we're doing. And so I think I just want to finish off there as a reminder that, you know, often children who are, as many have shared this morning, very passionate about the climate emergency and being part of the solutions, but also that responsibility often lies with adults in order to support them to bring about these changes.
Thanks very much, Katie. That's some fascinating insights into the perspective of children in this area, and I'm sure fellow members will want to take some of those issues forward. But let me bring in Liam Fowley of the Scottish Youth Parliament and address the same question to Liam.
Thank you, Convener, and morning, everybody. Thank you, firstly, for inviting SYP, the democratically elected voice of young people in Scotland. I'll first off state that everything that I'll discuss here is something we have discussed with young people as well. We've consulted young people on these issues consistently over the past 3-4 years, actually, and all our national campaigns over the last 3 years have had an element of climate change, environment, etc., involved in them, which gives you a flavour of the importance young people place on them. I think as well, Katie and I will probably start singing from the same hymn sheet, because a lot of children and young people have the same views, perspectives and experience, this sort of thing. The main thing when we talk to young people about this is about education on how to live sustainably. Young people don't always have access to that, and if they do have access, it's not consistent across the board, even from not only local authority to local authority, from school to school. As well as that, young people find that they wish to live sustainably or try and make sustainable choices, but they don't feel they have the accessibility to do that. So they don't have the affordability, or they don't know where to start when it comes to this sort of thing, are the main highlights as well. Active travel is a massive part of young people and young people's views on this as well. They really want to be considered to take active travel, to have the ability to active travel. But again, the infrastructure they feel is not there, especially in more rural communities, and they don't feel they've got the affordability to try and get into active travel either. I think I'll just keep it short and sweet there, and I won't repeat anything Katie said either.
Well, thanks very much, Liam, and thank you to all the panel members. That was a fascinating opening exchange, and you've set the ground well for other members to follow up on some other issues. And at this stage, let me bring in Colette Stevenson, who has a supplemental question in this area.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to each of the panel, and thanks for your contributions within the Climate Citizen Assembly. It's very thought-provoking. One of the things, I thought it was very timely that yous were in attendance today, given the fact that we've got our UN Climate Change Youth Climate Conference today in Italy. And I was just wondering at all if yous had any interaction with them. I know there's two young people attending from the UK. And I was just wondering if there has been any interaction at all about ideas and, you know, putting, you know, things concrete, you know, things going forward. And also as well, do you hope to interact with them, if you haven't already, on the back of this conference as well, and hope to share some, you know, good ideas going forward? I'll put that to Liam and Katie.
Liam, would you like to go first, then I can come in after?
As an organisation, we haven't engaged with the event in Italy, but we are doing work on the sidelines of it, I should say, as well. So we have, I think it's a co-project coming up shortly on the moment, which is an event for children and young people to get involved and have discussions with decision makers about the climate change, environment, sustainability, and how they want to see the world change. And so we're promoting young people into getting into these conversations, and locally, nationally as well. And we've also not had anything, as you say, in relation to Milan. We're very supportive of it, we should state, and we do believe children and young people should be at the heart of these decisions, because we know they're going to be the most affected by them.
Thank you.
Thanks, Liam. Just to add to Liam's there, I just wanted to say, you know, the children's participation in Scotland's Climate Assembly is, as far as we know, a kind of world first. And there has been a lot of international interest in the fact that children here in Scotland have been brought into this deliberative democratic process. And as a result, we're working with Scotland's Climate Assembly to really support children's participation in the kind of influencing element of the Climate Assembly in the run-up to the report from Scottish Government, which is due by the end of this year. And as part of that, that's supporting children to also engage with the international kind of forum around climate emergency, connecting with other children and young people around the world to talk about their experiences holding leaders to account over climate action. And yet, just to add to Liam's point about the moment, we're really encouraging elected representatives here in Scotland to reach out to children and young people in their communities to support them to host a climate surgery on the 29th of October, the week before COP26. And our intention behind that is to support children and young people to know what to, or to support decision makers to take forward children's calls to action when they themselves are engaged in conversations at COP26.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Colette, let me bring in Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you very much, and welcome to your parliament, to your parliamentary committee. The Climate Assembly report, I think, was very clear, very direct, and set out clear actions that are expected to be delivered, and the Parliament debated it with a cross-party support and indication previously. So you're in a very powerful position. I just wondered if you could explain the journey that people were on as part of that Climate Assembly, that clearly some people will have come in with particular views at the start, but there was an evidence base and a great deal of consideration and understanding, and then your ranking. And I just wondered if you could maybe give us an indication of what issues you think shifted most during the course of the Assembly's work, to give us an idea of perhaps what we have to challenge most in people's understanding and in terms of how we get that change, behavioural change that the convener talked about. Perhaps, I don't know whether Jocelyn wants to go first.
Certainly. It was a very interesting journey. You know, we were selected over 100 people from a very broad range of experiences and a very broad range of opinions on the importance of climate change, how much we believe that it was an urgent issue. And I think throughout the course of 7 weekends, we saw expert witnesses discuss all different kinds of issues from, you know, heating, transport, lifestyle, diet, land use. And I think this deliberative journey, you know, we were broken into two different streams. There was so much information that we couldn't all listen to this expert information all the time. And the stream I was in was diet, lifestyle, and land use. And the amount of information that was presented by expert witnesses in each of these streams was phenomenal. And I think that everyone, I would say almost certainly, underwent quite an expansive experience in learning about climate change. I think a lot of people are unaware of the breadth of of our carbon footprint. I think a lot of people think about fossil fuels. They think about home heating, insulation, but they don't think about our general consumption, about the building industry, about agriculture and food waste. So I think, you know, as an assembly, we came to realize the complexity of the problem. It's not just one or two things, but I think the key issues, I think for me certainly, and were the recognition of agriculture and food, what the role that they play in the climate emergency, transport. I think transport and travel is a very big sector. And this is a sector that has actually not been showing any decrease in emissions over the last few years. So this is something that I feel we recognized really needs to be tackled. Certainly the increase in air emissions over the last 15 or 20 years has grown substantially. Also, private car use. These are major issues that I feel the Assembly wants to tackle. We weren't also just looking at how to reduce our emissions. We were looking at a more holistic approach. How can we, you know, the question we were given was, how should Scotland change, tackle the climate emergency in an effective and fair way? And so that effective and fair way also played a very big role in what we were looking at in the Assembly. And as a result of that, we have issues of things like, how do we measure happiness? How do we measure not just using GDP as our, you know, our index, how we can develop 20-minute communities, things that actually looked at dealing with the climate emergency in a more holistic approach. And I think one of the main things of generating our recommendations and producing this very comprehensive and very ambitious report was to start that discussion. You know, we have given, hopefully in our report, Parliament a set of recommendations, a set of overarching goals we have identified. And it's hard to pinpoint one or two because they are so interlinked and they are so important. And I know, as you know, during our process, we were told, try to focus on the main things, you know, try to produce a report that has is very focused rather than too broad, you know, so that it's a bit, you know, vague. But it was almost impossible for the assembly members to limit things because all of the expert information we gave was so important. So we do have a lot of overarching goals. We do have a lot of recommendations, but I think, you know, we realized how important it was to look at all of this. We've given Parliament this report. We've said, these are the things we think are important, we'd like you to look at. And, you know, this is what we would like the discussion to be about. It was an amazing process. And I think everyone who came out of there, personally speaking, it has changed the way I live my life and the choices that I make. So it was a very positive thing.
And I know that my colleagues will pick up on a number of the areas that you've raised. My other question was about communities. There's a strong recommendation about empowering communities in the report to develop localised solutions to tackle climate change. So if either yourself mm-hmm. or indeed your colleague from the Climate Assembly would want to address that. And you also talked about learning and understanding and being such an important process for the Climate Assembly itself. I can maybe ask Liam in particular if he'd like to comment on progress, particularly on climate education for young people. So the community's questions to the Climate Assembly and the education's questions to Liam. So Liam, do you want to go first on climate education and then we could maybe go to the camera's on you, so we yeah. thought we...
okay, right. Shock for me. Surprise. Okay. Yeah, that's totally fine. So as I mentioned before, education is probably the biggest one young people will discuss about. We did a national campaign kind of 2019-20, and that national campaign was decided by 10,000 young people in Scotland to be, it was Pack It Up, Pack It In is what it was called, and that specifically consulted young people all over Scotland from a diverse range of backgrounds, not just the same areas. So we had a good cross-section of community experiences there, just to see what the difference were between each young person's experiences in school, specifically education. And one of the major calls was about education. They wanted to do something, but they didn't know what to do, how to do it, what they were actually going to be doing that about. And that hasn't really changed over the period. We've done our manifesto consultation as well recently, which is a further large scale consultation piece of work, which again included strong representation from children and young people that education had to be improved. Not only education that they get at the moment is a very small scale, scratch the surface sort of element, excuse me, but the real changes that they had to make weren't being included. The Climate Change Act, Key Household Climate Change Education Economics all need to be included as what was specifically there. So the food element on living sustainability and physical education, the active travel elements were considered to be in there from children, young people in there as well. In education as well, there's always this call for human rights-based approach on it, and that not only but as education as a whole, but in the climate sphere as well, that young people should be involved in making that education, co-designing the curriculum as well, because young people know what they want to learn more about and they maybe know areas in certain aspects as well. One of the biggest points is about continuity, that you know, one young person in one local authority is getting a very different experience of climate education to another young person in another local authority. And we have seen instances where that differs even from school to school. Consistency is key there. Even taking it right back to the smaller steps of things like picking up your litter and why it's important. Young people don't always understand that because they haven't been told why it's bad. They've just been told it is bad. They don't understand the full negative effects it'll have as well. So young people call for the understanding. They feel like they've seen their colleagues, or many young people are climate engaged, and they want to make a change. They're doing their own research. There is the other sector of young people that are not engaged, but they want to be, and they don't know how to start because they've not been given the education there in a consistent approach.
Thank you. And I'm very conscious of time, colleagues, but perhaps if Jocelyn from the Climate Assembly could talk about communities and your recommendation about empowering communities, and particularly what funding and resource you think are needed to help people take power themselves and to take action.
Yes, okay. Our thinking behind the community recommendations was, again, to do with this one size does not fit all, and it's important that local communities are enabled to take initiatives to do things that work for them. So again, echoing much of what was just said, it's things about local transport issues. It might be local heating. I think one of the things is community low carbon heating was discussed. So you might develop systems of heating for social housing, areas of social housing, things along that line. Recycling. One of the things we discussed, was upgrading recycling centres into reuse centres. And I think this is quite something that is very important. So much of our food waste, our general waste, ends up in landfill sites where it produces large amounts of methane. So we talk about carbon, our carbon footprint, but it's really our greenhouse gas emission footprints, because we also have a lot of methane that is being produced. And so it's things along that line. We're looking at social housing aspects, heating and active transport, also local, being able to develop local skills to work in some of these areas of businesses that we want to encourage people to shop locally, to recycle things locally. The funding, I'm not really in a position to, that was not my stream, and I'm not really sure about the funding for these things. We did talk about funding for the local reuse centres, and I think that was an amount equivalent to the current value that's given for the recycling centres to upgrade that facility. But there's also initiatives for, I think, community land purchase, if that was, something that could be used on a local community level. But it is all about enabling these communities to develop a system and put in place a system that helps them locally reduce their carbon or greenhouse gas emissions.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Fiona. Let me bring in Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. This is fascinating so far. I've had the privilege of taking part in some Zoom events with Climate Assembly members. I've met some of the children here at Parliament, and there's so many questions. But I suppose, in terms of starting somewhere, I was struck by Jocelyn saying earlier on that people do want to do the right things, and also talked about tackling climate change in a way that is fair for everyone. So can I maybe just get a sense of some of the barriers that were discussed? So for the 100 and so people who were involved in the Climate Assembly, people came from different backgrounds, but aside from education and perhaps knowledge, what other barriers are people facing in terms of making those behavioural changes, and how concerned are people about the affordability of some of the proposals and the impact that might have on people who are already experiencing, for example, fuel poverty, which has been mentioned? Maybe come to Jocelyn on that, and I'm happy for others to indicate they want to answer.
Well, fuel poverty, I think it's, I think that the statistic is something along the lines of 25% of households at the moment live in fuel poverty. One of the things that would greatly help to tackle that is if we were able to upgrade the energy efficiency of our homes. I think I mentioned earlier, a lot of the homes in Scotland are very old. They've been built of stone. They're not well insulated. They have damp. It's just the type of housing that, we have inherited over the years in Scotland. And I think when you talk about the barriers, that prevent people from doing things, two of the things that I would identify are that people don't know what to do. It's their home energy efficiency. And there is a financial problem able to do this as well. And one of the things that we did recommend was that that grants, you know, there are grants made to all this would be very costly, but we would have considerable savings made through our energy reductions. So I think it was 2025 that we recommended that grants are given to homeowners by improving our energy efficiency in our homes, by replacing our boilers. This will greatly, you know, help to reduce fuel poverty because people will not have to spend so much, you know, money heating their homes.
Thank you, Jocelyn. I'm not sure maybe if Katie wants to add from a children's perspective. I know when we've had a chat before, there were children who came to the Parliament who'd never been on public transport before, and I think there's a danger that as politicians we make assumptions about people's living standards, about their knowledge, but how do we make sure that everyone gets to play their part in tackling climate change and that issues around poverty and just lack of awareness are not holding young people back?
The first part of that was missed, so I hope I've managed to catch that all right. It's just there was a slight delay with the camera and the audio, but essentially with your question around the barriers that children themselves are facing, would you mind repeating just so I've got that?
Yes, I was just briefly reflecting on the fact that we've met before at the Parliament with some young people, and we talked about the fact that for some young people that had been their first time on a train, and you know, we often make assumptions about people's living standards and backgrounds. So how do we make sure this is really inclusive and that all children can participate? We've talked about the importance of education, but what else can we do, Katie?
Thank you for repeating that, and the joys of the challenges of digital working can make both difficult. But I think your question is really important, as it's one that allows us to reflect on the climate crisis as a children's rights crisis. Children are acutely aware that people, children and adults, have completely different lifestyles, experiences, circumstances here in Scotland and throughout the Climate Assembly. We're reflecting on their own lives and some of the challenges that they experience in their day-to-day lives, and looking at how those for themselves can be barriers, but also thinking in a kind of compassionate and empathetic way about how other children are going to be impacted by the climate crisis, and also the barriers that they face to bringing about the kind of changes and solutions that we need to see here in Scotland. I think some of the things that you've highlighted there around education and it's essentially making sure that that children from all walks of life have that opportunity to engage in conversations and be part of the solutions in their schools, in their homes and communities. That was really clear, the evidence that came through the whole process, that children want to be part of the solutions and want to find opportunities to connect with people in their schools and homes to share these ideas that they have. So essentially ensuring that children's participation is at the heart of community-led action as well, and to support an intergenerational approach to the climate crisis where children's rights are upheld. I think in specific to some of their calls to action around how children and adults can work together might be of particular interest to you and those here today. Children are really passionate about thinking about the well-being element of the climate crisis. And obviously there's a real surge in evidence showing how the climate emergency can be incredibly anxiety inducing, and there's a lot of concern for the impact that the kind of the media, the news, the general kind of debate around climate change is having on children when they're kind of absorbing that information. But children themselves, when able to engage in this in a really hope-based and children's rights-based way, feel empowered and supported to be part of the solution. And that can stem to also how they build those relationships with adults in their communities and their schools and their homes, and how that they can be part of those conversations. So I do think some of their calls to action around community-led, like community gardens, finding opportunities for kind of shortening the school and work hours so that children and adults can come together and be part of kind of community-led projects such as sharing libraries, creating spaces for recycling centres, and coming together for other types of initiatives that can support those kind of relationships to build, also helps to create that intergenerational approach to tackling the climate change crisis.
Thank you, Katie, and I wish the Children's Parliament well with the launch of the Climate Changemakers scheme. Just briefly, I have a question for Liam. Liam, we had the Transport Minister giving evidence to committee this morning, and really pleased that the committee has supported the statutory instrument on increasing national bus travel concession scheme to include 19 to 21 year olds. I know many people would like that to go further to include people up to the age of 25, and there's a wider campaign to go further again. So how important is it, from your point of view, from Scottish Youth Parliament, that under 25 year olds have access to that? And alongside the concessionary scheme, you did talk about some of the challenges, particularly in rural areas, about access to bus services. How much of a problem is this? And, you know, if we don't have good public services, can people really play their part in decarbonising transport and helping to address climate change?
Yeah, thank you. And it was fantastic to catch earlier the approval of the statutory instrument. That is an amazing step in the right direction, which young people are incredibly grateful for. And it's going to see, I think it will see a true difference in Scotland and how we all play our part. Yes, it's a step in the right direction. Of course, there is always more to go in that. As you say, extending that to under 25s and the rail networks as well. But that's all useful, but if there's no accessibility or the infrastructure is not there, that becomes an issue. Therefore, they can't utilise it as much. Rurally, young people, it's a massive issue. And not only rurally, if I take my own situation to be quite selfish, if I want to get a train to my place of work on a Sunday, there is no hope of me being able to do that. I have to make a decision to drive or try and find alternative transport or lift share or something along those lines. The accessibility isn't there for young people, more so in rural communities. The longer journeys, the time of the journeys are obviously longer, but therefore the buses are less frequent, for example. And young people want to try and make these changes. Frankly, it can be easier to get the bus and train, but it's just not a viable option. The affordability aspect will hopefully now change as well, but especially rurally, affordability is just a no-go. And in relation to public transport as well, safety of young people is one that's regularly brought up, not only in public transport, but in school contracts, for example, as well. Are the seatbelts working? Are the buses overcrowded? And when particularly young people identify as female, when they come home from an evening out, for example, they probably want to make the decision to get a taxi over getting a bus because they don't feel safe getting on public transport. So there's the safety and the infrastructure barriers there. The concessionary travel will make a great difference in relieving that, because train fares and bus fares have just not been viable for young people, especially if they're on low-paying jobs, as they tend to be in part-time employment. It is a major barrier for them. And yes, the concessionary travel will certainly help that, but there's still a long way to go in making transport more equitable, more accessible for young people, and making sure they truly can access it and make the right decisions.
That's all very helpful. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Monica. Colette Stevenson to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thanks really much. I just wanted to ask Katie, when you touched upon, you know, education and climate education as well. And again, like that, it was really thought-provoking, and even some of the reactions coming from the young people as well and how they can be involved. We're rolling out the deposit return scheme, so I wanted to ask about that. I know within East Kilbride, which is the constituency that I cover, we did a pilot scheme with the reverse vending, and it was an incentivisation to collect litter and with the 20p return What they did was, rather than keeping it for themselves, there was some kind of incentivisation scheme that they'd done a sort of more for the full school. So, there was a competition that was sort of competitive. Is that something that you've seen yourself when you've been working with the Children's Parliament in terms of, you know, incentives and initiatives to roll out to sort of try and promote climate change locally?
Thanks very much for the question. It's not something that I've come across in terms of our conversations with the children, and I think in this instance it would be worth speaking to children and young people directly themselves. I don't feel in a position to be able to answer on their behalf. I would just like to add, last week we did have an event with the children where they reflected on the process of the Climate Assembly, which will be launching online tomorrow, the recording from it. So in order for people here today to hear from them directly on some of these issues, I would urge to have a watch of that tomorrow.
Well, that's good to know. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Colette. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks. I was struck actually just by what Liam was saying around public services and, you know, how we kind of get that public voice into public services, particularly, you know, if we're rolling out under 22's free bus travel, and there's still concerns that young people might have about safety or about quality of services. Do you see a kind of value around this type of process, this kind of deliberative democratic process, in terms of how we get the voice of people into how public services are managed? And if so, what does that look like? Does it look like an assembly? Does it look like a citizens' jury? Or so I'm interested in your perspectives on how we, because this seems to have been a very successful process. I'm absolutely delighted that it's come up with such a, you know, substantial report, as much for government to consider in there. But I'm just thinking about how do we sort of embed this type of deliberative democracy more deeper as we start to, you know, tackle the climate emergency and actually reform public services in a way. So I don't know if Liam, Katie, if you want to kick off.
Thank you very much. It's a really important question, and something young people do feel strongly about, because we discuss with them a lot about this, not only on the climate, but on all issues that young people should really be at the heart of these decisions being made and being involved in a meaningful participation process, not a tokenistic one. I think especially over the past 18 or so months with the COVID-19 pandemic, young people have felt ignored. And we've seen through our own organisation that young people are now really trying to get their voices heard more and more, which is, of course, fantastic to see. The processes need to be meaningfully dealt with. They need to be co-designed with young people. And these are really long. They end up being longer processes. They can't just be, let's crack a young person into this meeting, because that's not meaningful participation. Getting young people actively listened to, you're feeding back on what these young people are saying. You're saying, this is what we've done, or this is why we can't do it. Getting them to make recommendations and review things for you as well. Giving them the feeling like they've got the power, because they do have the power. They'll have the equitable power, as you do, for example, or the other people in the room, is a really important point. Young people do want to be engaged in this. This is not, you're not going to struggle to find young volunteers to get their views heard on this one. Because they are very active in this sphere, not only climate, but in general decision-making, that when we engage with young people, they are engaged with meaningfully. We're getting a broad range of ages, voices, races, sexualities and experiences, young refugees, for example, as well. All stuff that it does provide really good insight and thought-provoking opinions. And there's no one-size-fits-all arrangement is an important point as well. So I wouldn't say a specific example of what would be required for a specific discussion, but a meaningful one is probably the overarching statement in favour.
Yeah. And maybe if I could sort of bring Katie in as well on this and just ask, like, who should really lead on this? I mean, this has come from an amendment to a Climate Change Act. It's been government that's commissioned this. But, I mean, does it have to start that way? Could this be driven by schools or councils, or should it be being driven by, I don't know, public service operators themselves? Or where's the starting point for this type of work?
Sorry, I guess the starting point is the commitment here in Scotland to the forthcoming incorporation of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is about the realisation of children's rights, of which part of that is their right to participate in decision-making processes. And thinking about younger children, I know Liam's spoken really powerfully about the contribution that young people make to decision-making here in Scotland and the appetite there for young people to be part of the decisions being made here in Scotland. If we're thinking about younger children, you know, right from birth up to kind of teenager age, if you like, where there's less opportunity to have a say in decision-making processes, we've really got to think about what actually works for children of this age. And Liam alluded to the fact that it takes time. It certainly does take time. It also takes a lot of creativity. And it does take a lot of commitment from adults to do things a bit differently. And I do think, reflecting on the Climate Assembly as a process, when we were invited by the Secretariat to support with the meaningful participation of children in the Climate Assembly, it allowed us an opportunity to kind of like rethink what deliberative democracy can look like when you involve all generations. And just reflecting on the process kind of from October to March, when the children were going through the deliberations just like the adults were, and then feeding in through short films, and then having kind of dialogue back and forth between the children and adults towards the end when they were forming their recommendations and calls to action. But also thinking about what's happened since is really interesting, because what we're seeing is that the children are equal parts. Like, you know, I'd love to hear Jocelyn's reflection on this if possible. But what we have seen is how, you know, the adults' attitudes throughout that process, many attitudes change as a result of the children's participation. The children actually encouraged adults to take some of their recommendations further. The children's calls to action were stronger, and therefore the adults had to reflect on their own and actually strengthen them before laying them in Parliament. And so I guess what's happened there is that by bringing all generations together, we're actually kind of accurately representing, you know, the mini Scotland that assemblies seek to achieve. And therefore, it really does set us on a really positive path if we're thinking about realising children's participation rights. How can citizens' assemblies, whether that's a national level, a local level, community level, it could be a school level, how can we use that model, improve on it, and work to include all generations going forward? And just one other point about this kind of this current phase, like, your children have been meeting with the adult assembly members and cabinet secretaries and ministers to discuss their calls to action and their recommendations. And I think just seeing the children in that space, you know, it's far from child friendly, but the children have loved it. And they've said, actually, being able to be part of those conversations has shown us that our contribution to the Climate Assembly is just as important as the adults. And so I do think there's a lot to reflect on and learn from this past year. And I do think, as a model, I know there's a commitment within the manifesto from SNP, for example, to make children's contributions part of citizens' assemblies. So really keen to see how this progresses, and from our own experience here at Children's Parliament, happy to advise on what's worked, what could be done better, and how we can work with children to make sure this works for them.
Jocelyn, have you got any reflections on what Katie was just saying there in terms of the involvement of young people and that kind of exchange idea, that cross-fertilisation of ideas, I think, between generations?
Yes, I mean, it was excellent, and I agree with everything that Katie said. Having the children as part of the assembly experience was amazing. We often saw videos that they had produced about what they were thinking, how they were, you know, dealing with things in their own assembly. And everyone in the adult assembly, after watching these videos, was so inspired and so encouraged. And if we were having a day where we were hearing particularly, you know, gloomy evidence on the future of, you know, our climate emergency, we were all uplifted by hearing from the children. And it was partly the way they were willing and able to deal with the situation, but also how they were willing to engage with the solution as well. And you really felt there is hope, because this is a generation that is coming up that are really willing to tackle this. They want to tackle this. And we were all inspired. And I think it did influence our thinking as well in a lot of ways. I think it is so important to have the children involved because they are the next generation, but they are also that link between the two generations. Children learn about climate change at school and they go home. They say, I want to plant a garden. I want to eat different food. And so much of what we've been talking about, the behavioural change, is about changing the norm. What, for instance, I do as an adult is so much influenced by what I did as a child. So in the West, we eat a lot of meat, for instance, but we do that because our parents did that and their parents did that. But we have the opportunity here to break that link, to create that behavioral change. So children can do that. They can grow up in a new norm in many ways, in their expectations of travel, in their dietary expectations, just in their attitudes towards consumption. They also can extend that link into the adult population. And I think this is a really important way that we can all tackle climate change together effectively.
Thank you very much. There's room just for one more question. I'm going to ask you, Jocelyn, just about something quite specific here. And it's in relation to, you know, how we change the places where we live. You know, there's been a big discussion during the COVID crisis about road space, about changing road space, you know, perhaps losing some car parking spaces, extending footpaths, changing the urban environment. I was wondering if that is something which came up during your conversations and what the thinking was about the need for that change, whether that was something that was supported or whether that was an issue that perhaps was ducked. I don't know, in the conversations.
It did come up in terms of the 20-minute communities, because I think the 20-minute communities, this is a system that has been used in other places around the world. I think it's been used successfully in San Francisco, comes to mind. But it is about making an environment where you have everything at hand. So in an environment like that, you have less of a need for cars. I mean, you can move more towards active transport. I think we need to move away from private car use. That was one of the things that we discussed. So in order to enable us to do that, again, we need to provide a local infrastructure that enables us to go about without needing cars. So the two are linked together, because even if we all use electric cars, there is still a huge carbon output from the cars themselves. So I think the assembly, the overall goal that we want to move towards is active transport and using, so we would want more space in our urban communities devoted to cycling paths and being able to promote active transport in that way.
Thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. Final question from Jackie Dunbar, please.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for coming along today. I'd like to ask Liam and Katie a question, if you don't mind. I'm keen to hear what you think the top priority is that the young people want us to hear today. What's a strong message that you want ringing in our ears by the time that we finish? Because I think it's pretty important that we hear this. I don't know who would like to go first, either Liam or Katie. Katie, ladies first.
I'm happy to go first. I think one of the resounding messages that's come through from the children is around involving children, and this is younger children as well as young people, in decisions being made about the climate emergency, and actively listening to children and making sure that they are fed back to as well, so that they know of what contribution that they've had and what that's led to, is really fundamentally important. And again, that links back to what both me and I have shared this morning about the importance of children's rights and ensuring that children's rights to a healthy environment are seen within the context of children's participation as well.
And Liam?
And on a very, very similar vein to Katie, make decisions with young people and not for them. Don't leave young people, or don't leave us, I should say, as an afterthought.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. I had one final question, actually, to the panel. COP26 is coming up in Glasgow in about 4 or 5 weeks' time. It's a unique opportunity to raise awareness about issues around climate change and hopefully highlight some of the behavioural change that is going to be required. I'd like to get a sense from the panel about how much public awareness you think there is around COP26 being held in Glasgow, and you know, what more can be done to promote not only the conference itself, but some of the issues around behavioural change? And perhaps I could start with Susie on that question and then bring in Liam.
Thank you very much indeed. I think there is a reasonable level of awareness. I think perhaps there's also a bit of scepticism around how much action is really going to be taken. And this really goes back to the question that Mr. Ruskell asked around citizens' assemblies more generally, that actually the Assembly members have done the most amazing things and have made incredibly detailed and specific recommendations and general recommendations. But what they now need is to see some action. And so I think that's really where the public perhaps are more widely with COP26 as well, that there is some ambition, but they're waiting to see where that really transforms into action. But maybe Jocelyn is better able to speak to the public view. I'll let Jocelyn come in.
Well, I think there is also, I would agree, a fair level of awareness. I think that people are very interested in watching to see what happens at COP26, because following the Paris Agreement, varying degrees of progress has been made in actually meeting the commitments that have been agreed to. And I think the public in general feel that it's, you know, as a global community, we're very good at signing up to these targets. But I think the public really need to see some action now about actually meeting these targets and seeing some real timetables in delivering on our promised pledges. I certainly think it's an amazing opportunity to be hosting COP26 in Glasgow, and I hope that you know, the benefits of just having the meeting there will ignite a certain enthusiasm in the public to tackle the climate emergency. I think people need to know why they're being asked to change. I don't think people will be against the change if they understand why they are needed. And I think we need to have a very clear link between what we're asking people to do, the behavioural changes we're asking them to make, and the reasons why these are necessary. I think that will be something that would be very worth pursuing to, you know, strengthen that link.
Thank you very much. And let me bring in Liam for his perspective on this question.
Thank you, Convener. I think I would agree with both Susie and Jocelyn there that there's a fairly reasonable amount of awareness of COP26. I think there's maybe not as much awareness about what's going to happen after COP26. I think at the moment there's just this awareness that there's a 2-week large-scale event happening and the roads will be closed. What's happening next and what's going to actually come of it, much like on the same vein as Jocelyn said. I would say in relation to young people, there's been an element of disheartenedness there, that young people haven't felt as engaged with this particular event in total. I think there is a lot of organisations doing good work on it, as I've said, it's been mentioned before. The Moment as part of that as well. We're now engaging young people, and I'm sure there's other organisations doing local elements as well. But what's the large scale engagement with children and young people, and what's the plan for that? I think whilst there's loads of great things going on in Scotland, is really good with engaging young people. I think there was probably more opportunity for engaging with young people in a constructive manner. But the awareness is there that COP26 is happening. And again, as Jocelyn said, the fact it's happening in Glasgow is really spurring conversation on nationally.
Thanks very much, Liam. Unfortunately, that brings us to the end of our allotted time for this session. Thank you very much to each of our panel members for being here this morning and for your fascinating insights into this area. And I'm sure we will be meeting again as the committee takes our work programme forward. I will now suspend the meeting for a panel changeover. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning. They are Terry Ahern, Chief Executive, Scottish Environment Protection Agency, Ian Gulland, Chief Executive, Zero Waste Scotland, and Nick Halfhide, Director of Nature and Climate Change, Nature Scot. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us this morning, and thank you to Nature Scot for your written submission to the committee in advance of this session. We have around 60 minutes for this session, just for your information. We will now move to questions. And my first question is to all of the panel members. It relates to what practical steps your organisation will take to achieve the transition to net zero, what you plan and how you plan to do things differently, and what are the key challenges you will face in the transition to net zero. Perhaps I could start with SEPA, move on to Zero Waste, and then Nature Scot. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Can I just clarify on the question? Are you talking about net zero in terms of our operations or in the work we do to influence others?
It's a good question. Both, actually, but primarily the latter in terms of your role in implementing policy towards net zero.
Okay, great. So SEPA has two fundamental roles. We have a role in flooding as the warning, alert and strategy organisation in the flooding system, and we regulate about 34 sectors of the economy. In the main way we'll help with net zero is through our regulatory work. So what we've done under our One Planet Prosperity strategy is traditionally what EPAs do, and it was right to do in the what I call the first phase of EPAs, is deal with individual site issues. Those individual site issues tend to be about local pollution. The most high profile one in the last few years has been the flaring incidents at the Exxon Shell site at Moss Morin. We will continue to be very tough and hard on those and work with businesses to solve those problems. What we've added is what we think few EPAs do, which is have a big focus on these systemic issues such as the climate emergency or the nature emergency. So we have a sector planning approach. So for example, our most compliant sector the last few years has been the whiskey sector. Most of the distilleries are highly compliant. The whiskey industry itself has objectives about decarbonising, using fewer materials, using water, because water scarcity, particularly in the part of Scotland where majority of distilleries are, is an increasing issue, partly because of climate change. So our new approach is to continue to focus on those site issues, but the big thing we're doing differently is to work with those sectors on how do they decarbonize, and not just at their sites, but through their supply chain. So for example, in the whiskey sector, one of their biggest impacts in terms of climate change is it's a boutique and high quality product. So it's in very heavy bottles, which are very energy intensive to produce and then very energy intensive to transport. This is an industry that gets that. They understand the future. They're trying to innovate. We see our role as a regulator is how do we work with the industry and other bodies such as Zero Waste Scotland to support them in that innovation. Another example would be, and I'll just continue with that sector, we regulate both the whiskey sector and say the barley growers. Now they both face water scarcity because of climate change. How do we work with them, not distillery by distillery or farm by farm, but the sectors together and say, let's come up with systemic solutions to reducing water use. That will both, when you're using less water, you'll tend to use less energy. So you'll be cutting greenhouse gas emissions and you will be dealing with one of the consequences of climate change. So, you know, I could go through many examples, but the key thing I would say to the committee is, there are lots of other things we could do, like education programs, etc. When I got to SEPA, I said, look, Keep Scotland Beautiful and others run those. We'll contribute. Let's not duplicate. Let's not double up. We're a regulator. Let's take the strategic approach with industries and help them innovate to reduce their carbon emissions. The one other example I'll quickly give is in the Grangemouth area, where the government officials from the industry side have asked us to head up a regulatory hub. So there's a number of businesses we regulate at the Grangemouth complex. The Grangemouth complex needs to decarbonise over time, a just transition. How does regulatory innovation, not just by SEPA, but by the range of regulators out there, both Scottish and UK and local, from the local council, How do we support innovation towards net zero? How do we make powerful, quick, nimble decisions that get behind business innovation, quickly say no to the wrong things for the environment, and quickly say yes to the things that will help Scotland make that transition? So that's our main way of focusing on net zero, convener. It's through the way we regulate in a more strategic and innovative way.
Thanks very much, Terry. Let me address the same question to Ian Gulland, please.
Okay, thank you very much, convener. Thanks for the opportunity to come along today. So in terms of the immediate focus on emissions, certainly territorial emissions, GLA Scotland is very much focused on supporting existing recycling and reuse operations across Scotland, both at local authority level and at private sector, to increase performance. But also we are obviously working very closely with the Scottish Government on the roadmap, the waste and circular economy roadmap, which will set out ambitions, you know, to hit the targets of 2025 and beyond, i.e. the 2030 targets. So we're very much focused on that, very much focused on reducing food waste, obviously, as well, not just in household level, but through the whole supply chain. But obviously, from a household point of view, it's, you know, food waste in Scotland is almost three times the impact on climate change that plastics have. And most people are very animated around taking action on plastics, but food waste is one of the big challenges that we still need to address. Zero Waste Scotland also provides support to all businesses in Scotland to not just reduce resources, but also energy efficiency. On behalf of the Scottish Government, we run a very intensive programme, particularly for SMEs. We also provide low carbon heat expertise to a number of the large scale projects that are now being developed and put in place in Scotland. And we've also been working with a number of public bodies, agencies, to both develop their own net zero plan, but to deploy strategies using our own experience at Zero Waste Scotland and our own tools. But also we're obviously very focused not just on the territorial emissions, but the consumption emissions that Scotland has. So 80% of our carbon footprint comes from the production and use of materials and products, half of which come from outside of Scotland. So, you know, also that contributes significantly, not just to climate change, but also to global biodiversity loss. 90% of biodiversity loss and water stress globally is accountable to the extraction of raw materials for those products and materials. So, a recent report by Zero Waste Scotland highlighted that for every one person in Scotland, we consume 18.4 tonnes of materials. So, it's something that we're very keen to address, and that is about invading the circular economy, not just in our everyday lives, but in every sector and business in Scotland. So we have quite a range of services and support to individual companies, to sectors as well. And you say, what are we doing differently? Very much working in partnership with the likes of SEPA and economic agencies in Scotland as well to target real impactful opportunities in key sectors in Scotland, where we know that not just that there's a carbon saving to be made, but more importantly, there's an economic gain in terms of creating jobs and inward investment. Also, as an organisation, we've got quite an ambitious zero waste plan ourselves to reduce our impact and achieve the targets. We're already net zero ourselves, but we know we can go further. Clearly, you know, we've highlighted the fact that during COVID, you know, working at home reduced our whole operation footprint by almost 75%. So on the back of that, we've decided to embed home working and agile working going forward. But you said what we do need to do differently is follow that partnership approach, not just with government agencies, the private sector, sectors and local communities and local authorities. You know, we can't do this alone. We can't, you know, I say to many, you know, there's quite a queue at our door for support, both from the private and public sector and third sector. We can't do this alone. We need to empower and upskill not just other agencies, but other parts of society to provide the support both for themselves and for their member organisations and individuals in their communities. So a big part of our focus needs to be on how do we upskill, how do we embed the knowledge and expertise that we have in as much of Scotland as possible so we can hit those targets.
Thanks very much, Ian. And same question to Nick Halfhide, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone. So at NatureScot, our starting point is that the climate change crisis is inextricably linked with the nature biodiversity crisis. And we have to tackle the two together, because there's no point in tackling one without also tackling the other, because we have to do both together. So our work is really characterized in three areas in relation to climate change at the moment, all of which are predicated on the restoration of nature and natural systems. The first is about reducing emissions from nature. So we're working heavily to restore peatland and to retain and improve the amount of carbon that's in our soils, in our marine sediments. So that's to make sure that those don't release carbon or reduce the amount that they release into the atmosphere. The second is action with nature to sequester carbon. That's working not only around trees, both conifers and native woodlands, but across all our habitats. We're working in, for example, our coastal areas to improve the coastal habitats so that they sequester carbon, but also help to protect our coastlines from erosion. But also looking to expand our native woodlands, for example, the Scottish Atlantic rainforests, and also improve the soils in our farming areas, because these are potentially big sequesters of soil. Thirdly, often the Cinderella, I think, of all our work around climate change is our adaptation work. We know that there is an amount of climate change that is already going to happen. It's embedded in the system. So we need to make our nature, our natural systems, more resilient, because through making them more resilient, we will help to reduce the impact of climate change. So the increased drought that we're expecting, particularly in the east of the country, the more dramatic rainfall and flooding that we expect further in the west, and also very significant coastal erosion. So we're tackling all of these three simultaneously. And what we know from nature-based solutions is that the sooner we implement them, because there's a time lag, we need to do them quickly so that we get the benefits as soon as possible. What we're doing differently within NatureScot is ramping up the scale and reach of our work. We've been very active for many years across the restoration of nature, but we need to move much more quickly. So we need to upscale, for example, our peatland restoration work. We need to work much more quickly with local authorities on things like coastal protections through sand dunes and salt marshes. We need to work very closely with the Forestry Commission and landowners, Scottish Forestry, and landowners to improve the rate at which both native woodlands and conifers are planted, and so on. Many challenges around this, the scale. Whilst we are absolutely ramping up the amount of work we're doing, we need to make sure that all our partners are also able to ramp up, and that's both within the public sector, working with local authorities and other public agencies, but crucially, and you heard earlier on about communities, how we can increase the skills and capacity within communities to do a local actions and to take advantage of the advice that agencies such as NatureScot can bring on the funding, but how they can activate that at a local level. And finally, within the organisation, like most public bodies, we're on a rapid journey to net zero ourselves. Both within our kind of buildings and transport, but also the way we manage our land. So we own about 30,000 hectares of land that already sequesters a considerable amount of carbon, over 7,000 tons a year. So how can we increase the amount that sequesters, and also help in the resilience of those communities in the immediate vicinity of our land? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a brief follow-up question for each panel member, and a brief answer would be very welcome if possible. Do you have targets or metrics you track to, or you follow or measure to look at the progress of your actions and the impact of your actions? And again, perhaps if we could follow up with the same order as before, starting with Terry Ahern.
In terms of our own performance, which I didn't talk about, so our own greenhouse gas emissions, we will have targets which we'll track. We've reduced over 50% over about the past 10 years, so we'll be setting targets each of the following years. In terms of the way we regulate, we would have measures and targets for a couple of programs where we run mandatory regulatory activity, the emissions trading scheme, the CRC. So there'll be a number of businesses we regulate on carbon, and we'll have measures in there. With the other work I talked about, we won't have targets because it's voluntary work on behalf of the businesses. So we can regulate a distillery in the example, one of the two examples I talked about, and there'll be legal limits they have to meet for local discharges. The voluntary work of how do they decarbonise in their supply chain, we wouldn't have targets for, but we will make commentary and report on. And what we would do in all our work is look at the government's targets for each sector, try and align our effort to contribute to the government target for that sector being met, which is one of the advantages of our taking a sectoral approach, first time ever.
Thanks, Terry. Same question to Ian Gullen, please.
Hi. So all of our work is really framed by existing government targets, whether that's the recycling target for 2025, waste prevention target for 2025, also the food waste reduction target of 33% by 2025. Our work with businesses similarly to support them achieving those targets, and obviously the energy efficiency targets set by government. On the circular economy, also, I mentioned the material flow account numbers that we produced in the summer, and there is obviously an active conversation going on, not just with Zero Waste Scotland, but with government around what a metric could be for Scotland in terms of describing our circularity going forward. So there's obviously a global index for circularity at the moment, and a number of countries are looking at that as a way of training our circular economy activities in target setting. And internally, our net zero is our own target to reduce the actual absolute emissions as an organisation. We have them set and approved by our board, and we have an action plan in place. Obviously, as I said, we launched that plan before COVID, and the COVID experience has shown that we could go faster and quicker in terms of our wider footprint, and we're reviewing that target as we speak.
Thanks very much, Ian. And the same question to Nick Halfide, please.
Hi, yes. So we have some existing government targets and metrics, particularly around woodland expansion and peatland restoration. But beyond that, we are developing some, we will develop clear metrics and targets for nature restoration more generally. They will be presented in the new Scottish Biodiversity Strategy by October next year. And they will have, as a minimum within them, the international targets, which will be agreed, hopefully, at the COP15 Biodiversity UN Conference in Kunming in April and May next year. And internally, yes, we have absolutely have some very strong targets and metrics to get us to that net zero position as soon as we possibly can.
Thank you very much. I believe Liam Kerr has a supplemental in this area, to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Very briefly, Nick Halfide, on the answer you've just given. So you talked in your opening remarks about the crisis of nature and biodiversity loss, and then you've just spoken about the targets for biodiversity. Do you have plans then to kind of baseline biodiversity at the moment to ensure that the impact of any new policy ideas or the work that you talked about upscaling can actually be measured for to achieve those targets?
Monitoring already in place across a whole range of different biodiversity indicators, and that will be our baseline, so to speak. We're also undertaking some work internally at the moment, which we will engage with stakeholders in the coming months about what success would look like for 2045, so when we have halted the loss by 2030 and restored by 2045, we have agreed understanding amongst ourselves about what the success of a restored nature would look like. And we are obviously expecting targets to be embedded within legislation within the third year of this Parliament as well.
Thank you. I believe Monica Lennon has a brief supplemental in this area.
I do, thank you, Convener. Very briefly, just a follow-up question for Nick. Clearly, we're all concerned about biodiversity loss. Something that I've heard over the summer is that organisations are very concerned that we've had a loss of biodiversity officers and staff with expertise in local government. Is that something that you're aware of? Are we seeing a declining workforce in terms of the staff available to local government who can advise on biodiversity and protect the species? And if so, what can be done to address that?
Thank you. It's difficult for me to speak on behalf of local authorities because I don't have a full picture across the piece. But what I would say is that local authority is going to be absolutely key to driving forward local nature networks and to bringing together all the partners at a local level to drive forward a more integrated land use planning at that local level. To try and make sure that we've got all the different parts of a very complex system working as smoothly as possible, both for local benefit, but when you add it all together so that there's a clear national drive to halt the loss of biodiversity.
Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you and good morning. The Cabinet committee, when he appeared, that we're facing a twin crisis of a climate crisis and the crisis of nature and biodiversity loss. And that clearly biodiversity loss is as equally important as climate challenges and change. So I want to ask Nature Scott in particular, Nick, if you could say what do you think the government should be doing more of to ensure that the biodiversity loss is not somehow overshadowed by the climate change crisis, and to both SEPA and Net Zero, what are you doing as organisations to make sure that these twin crisis are being dealt with equal importance and priority. So, Nick, can I come to you first, please?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Thank you for this question. I think my first point is that all of the actions, pretty much, that we take to halt the biodiversity loss will have a benefit for dealing with climate change. So if we restore nature, it will help sequester carbon, reduce carbon being put into the atmosphere and make us more resilient. But the two are very closely interlinked. However, there are a couple of other things we have to be careful of, is that some of the things we do to solve the climate change problem aren't necessarily good for biodiversity. So we need to be careful when we are doing a lot of, for example, monoculture or growing crops to then burn for electricity. That's not necessarily for biodiversity, or how we do it is really important. What I would say is, to answer the question about what the government can do, is the government has set out a really very ambitious series of actions for Nature Scott and others to take forward, in particular the development of local nature networks and putting at least 30% of our land and seas in some form of protection so that the nature there is protected, and also the reforms, particularly to the common agricultural policy, as was how we help farmers. If we add all these things up, this is actually a really powerful way forward. However, there are probably one or two areas where we could move more quickly, possibly in the agricultural space, and we will need to do more in our uplands to try and help the upland areas where there's a lot of peat. There's also a lot of potential for the regrowth of native woodlands, how we can reduce the pressures that are keeping those peatlands from it being in poor condition. We can restore them. How do you retain them in good condition? And how do we allow our native woodlands in the uplands to flourish? And that comes around helping to deal with deer numbers and other herbivores, as well as to incentivize our land managers and our communities to really engage in the possibilities that these areas offer. And obviously to do that in a just transition way. A lot of these communities understandably feel very threatened by the changes that are coming, both at a business level, but also many rural communities rely on people working in the countryside. So we need to upskill and see there's an opportunity and that there's hope in a different way of managing the land to meet these broad biodiversity and climate change objectives.
Thank you. And SEPA? If we've not got them, maybe I should go to Net Zero first, then. I'm not sure. Oh, we've got Terry back. Terry, can we maybe come to you next if you heard my question?
Yes. So I think the targets that have been set are the critical thing for SEPA, because
For me, behind your question is the point that the history of environmental management, whether it's in any of our areas, has largely been about particular points in a system, whereas the biodiversity crisis, the climate emergency are about systems problems, so system solutions are needed. So my only comment really is that the targets, and the more the government can set clear targets and aims, the more it allows agencies like mine to style our programs to deliver against those systems challenges. So we have been given a set of quite powerful responsibilities by the Parliament, both to mandate things and also to help people on a voluntary basis. The thing that makes those, I think the thing for us that makes those most useful for whether it's the climate emergency or the nature emergency and the biodiversity crisis is to have those targets, goals set with clear policy aims and then allow us to get on and play our role in a coordinated way.
And Nets, have you anything to add to that? Ian, are you okay to?
Yeah, thanks. Just to echo, I think, what I said before about, 50% of global climate emissions and 90% of biodiversity loss and water stress comes from the extraction of materials from the earth. That, that's the real thing we need to think about if we're going to try and solve those two crises. And that is really down to the fact that we just use too much stuff as a global community, and we need to do something about it, hence our approach to the circular economy. But more importantly, the work that we're doing is obviously reducing demand. The circular economy reduces demand for virgin materials, therefore it eases pressure on some of the troubled parts of the world where biodiversity loss is more protracted, particularly thinking about textiles, reducing the demand for textiles, cotton particularly, and obviously food, where a third of all the food that's grown in globally is wasted. So if we didn't waste so much food globally, then there wouldn't be so much pressure on land for intensive agriculture. Obviously, similar to SEPA, we obviously, by eliminating waste, reducing waste, going to particularly landfill, we're going to tackling throwaway culture, like fly tipping and litter, that's going to reduce pollution, items being distributed in the environment, which again contributes to biodiversity loss. And obviously a lot of the work that we're involved in looking at circular solutions for organic material, both organic waste and byproducts from industry, can reutilize that back into whether that's regenerative agriculture or other applications on land to increase the carbon intensity, sorry, carbon sink, as well as the fertility of soils. That's going to not just reduce biodiversity loss, but actually increase biodiversity as well. So our work does directly impact on the biodiversity loss.
Thank you. My second question is about the programme for government and what it means in terms of priorities for you, in particular in relation to land use, if I can come to you on that. And I also have a small supplementary, but perhaps meaningful, that there's an increasing tendency in urban areas for people to pave over their gardens, etc. So I'd be interested in just a sense of land use from a very localised point of view as to what impact that may have in the short or longer term. But the big picture is about the programme for government. So again, perhaps I'll do it in the same order. Nick, then Terry, then Ian.
Thanks very much. Can I just clarify the question around the programme for government, if I may, Mrs. Lott?
So it's what are the big priorities for you from that? I'm also particularly interested in land use and what that means in terms of what that's requiring you to do and the priorities within that and any pressures that might have.
Okay, that's very clear. Thank you very much. Yeah, priorities for us within the programme for government. The first thing to say, it's across all land and sea. So whilst we're obviously thought of as often the people who do the protected stuff, we're actually having to work across all land and sea, because how we manage that is really important, not just for dealing with the biodiversity crisis, but also the climate crisis. So in protected areas, we will be looking to increase the amount of land that is protected for nature to 30%, both land and sea, and having meaningful management in place to make sure that that nature is as restored and revitalised as possible. But as important is how we work within the farming sector and the forestry sector and within the marine environment to try and or to encourage the change in practice. So, for example, within the agricultural sector, we move to a far more regenerative type of agriculture that protects and enhances the soils, makes space for wildlife within that sector, and again, doing the same within forestry. And coming to our urban areas, what we want to do is continue the work we've been doing for a number of years, but massively scale it up to try and bring nature within our cities. So I was on site just a couple of weeks ago to see how we're working with communities in a couple of tower blocks, about 2 hectares of land around and about, there's many car parks at the moment, how we can green that space for that community, bringing wildlife in, help dealing with localised flooding issues, make the land more porous, bring in butterflies and bees, the pollinators. And if we can do that across urban Scotland, we will increase how wildlife is into our cities, but also make our communities a much happier, more fulfilling place to be. Just to give you one example, when I was visiting on site in the south side the other week, a little girl comes up to me and says, I'm just so excited, as you're redeveloping the car park around us, you're going to put in a place for me to ride my bike. I've never had that before. So it's the human element as well as bringing in the wildlife element that I think is really important in that land use transformation from our cities right up to our mountaintops and out to sea and back again.
Thanks, Nick. And we can maybe come to Sipa. And it was interesting to hear about your going from concrete to green. My concern is going from green to concrete in some areas. But if we can maybe ask Sipa if they can talk about their priorities as well.
So broadly speaking, if you look at the overlay of the programme for government with the focus on creating a circular economy and a net zero emissions economy, etc., then that provides us with the basis, if you turn to land management, in the, I guess, the rural area, not too much to add to what Nick said in terms of farming. How do we help? We've got a lot of success. It was when I ran the Northern Ireland Environment Agency, the Ulster Farmers Union used to say, could you please look at the way SEPA works with the NFUS and try and bring some of that innovation back here. So there's a good record of working with the farming community in SEPA. A lot of that has been reducing individual impact. So again, as Nick was saying, how do we now use that strength of relationship and the success that's been had to make systemic change? So changes in farming practices that create a more regenerative form of farming that can not just reduce impacts on the environment, but actually regenerate and repair environmental damage. So our main focus will be working with the farmers union and some other interests on those sort of changes, rural area. In the urban area, what we've done is try and radically change the way we play our role as a planning consultee. So we have about 80 staff dedicated to commenting on planning applications. Now, when you think about that, we've got environmental experts that Scotland has paid for, and they're making a contribution when all the ideas are being formed and they comment towards the end and we might get a bit of change. So the flooding experts we have, what we've done is try and shift them to get up front, and Glasgow is a great example where there is still a lot of redevelopment opportunity along the Clyde, but all of that area is potentially at flood risk. Now you can just say, well, don't develop it, but we do want to have economic and social prosperity if there's an opportunity. So we've taken our flooding and planning experts and said, sit down with Glasgow City Council and the other councils, with Scottish Enterprise, with communities, with developers and businesses, take that flooding expert that Scotland has invested in and try and help people come up with innovative and creative ideas to use urban land in a very different way. Scottish Water is another partner in that. Now, we still always retain our right at the end of the process. We're very clear about this, so it's fair and open for people. If we want to recommend to a council that we don't think something should go ahead, we still reserve that right to do that, and that's proper. But why just do that only? Why not put that expertise that Scotland has invested in and put it up front in the system. So I've made a bit of a distinction between our approach, rural and urban. Some of the things cross over, but I hope that sort of explains the way we're trying to contribute to systems.
Thank you. And obviously, Scottish Canals also have done a lot with Glasgow, particularly in yes. development in terms of flood management. But that land use and flooding is maybe something we might want to come back to at some point. Ian from Net Zero, is there anything you want to add in terms of programme for government priorities? I'm not sure if the land use aspect is anything further to what you've already said.
No, I mean, we don't have anything specifically on land use, obviously, directly, but obviously, as I've said, a lot of our work does support, you know, land use more generally. Certainly, the focus for us is on that circular economy, acceleration of that, you know, looking at progress that we've already made and how can we scale that up. And obviously, the proposed circular economy bill will be a focus for us to support stakeholder engagement on that, and obviously government colleagues. The route map's mentioned. I've mentioned that already in terms of not just achieving targets by 2025, but what comes next in terms of ambition. And you know, there's obviously a £70 million investment programme in local authorities that we're involved in as well, and that very much looking at that as an opportunity to supply materials into our own circular economy opportunities here in Scotland. And yeah, there's mentions of continuing to tackle single-use plastics, work on textiles, mentioned that as well already, that will have impact hopefully on land use going forward, and yeah, further commitment to support producers to roll out the deposit return system for Scotland.
Thank you very much. Fiona Collette Stevenson, please.
Thank you, Convener. And, still good morning. Sorry, I was just checking the time there. So good morning to each of you, and thank you very much for your contributions. I wanted to really zone in on net zero. So, Ian, and ask you a few questions in terms of our waste. And also, I had a brief look at your submission in terms of your funding. And one of the questions I wanted to ask you specifically, which is in terms of net zero, was the EDF money that you get, and how long have you still to go with that? You know, is there any impact there going forward? When are you likely, has there been any impact? Are you getting support from the government when that stops as well? But the other one thing I wanted to touch upon, and within your submission, was about circular procurement. Putting my accountant's head on here, it's about visibility for me in terms of procurement and where our waste goes, and who effectively is dealing with our waste, from the household to the local authority, and just what role is the end destination reporting, the audit trail there in terms of our waste? Do you think that's something that's quite visible? Do you think that the local authorities have a bigger role to play and where that waste goes? So, for instance, if you have your local bin men picking up your waste, then it maybe goes to a Viridor site. So where's the visibility there in terms of that as well? And I suppose the other aspect is just recycling and reuse as well of products such as steel. What role you play and what advice you give out in terms of that as well? Thanks.
Okay, a couple of things, a few things there. So in terms of, thank you very much, the questions. So in terms of ERDF funding, yeah, we are obviously, our circular economy programme is supported by ERDF funding, European Structural Funds, which we've been investing in supporting businesses for a number of years now. In fact, it was one of the first European funds to actually support the circular economy. You know, when we applied, it was seen as a very pioneering approach by Scotland. So it's been quite a success in terms of learnings, but also now we have a very significant, healthy pipeline of businesses approaching us for support, which shows again, you know, that the circular economy is alive and thriving here in Scotland. But that funding, yeah, does come to an end. European Structural Funds, it will end in December next year. So obviously what happens, we're obviously in various discussions with both government colleagues and beyond government. You know, it's obviously not a follow-on programme as such. There's a thing that the UK government has proposed, the Shared Prosperity Fund, but how that's going to be deployed is not quite clear yet. So yeah, that is obviously a little bit concerning for us in terms of the healthy pipeline of businesses looking for support. If funding is not available. In terms of circular procurement, circular procurement, both in terms of what we buy, is very important. You know, how can we start to, you know, use particularly public sector procurement to really create a market for circular economy businesses here in Scotland? So thinking about rental, thinking about leasing. I think the question you particularly were asking about what happens to our resources, particularly from local authorities, after they've been collected, in terms of where they end up, and I think that is a valid point. I think there's obviously concern from time to time. We've watched TV programmes and we've seen UK plastics ending up in further parts of the world, being left kind of abandoned, next to jungles, and obviously plastics finding their way into the marine habitat as well. So I think that is obviously a concern. What does happen to our waste once it's been collected for recycling, in terms of the end destination? And I think more and more people are beginning to ask those types of questions. It's a bit like a lot of people want to know where their stuff is coming from now. So there's a growing demand from both consumers and businesses to say, well, where is my material coming from? And even what's the implications in that supply chain? Even thinking about child labour, critical materials, conflict areas of the world, what's happening. So people are much more, particularly clothing and stuff like that, but you're right, where does our stuff go to? I think there is a responsibility in all of us, both authorities and the private sector, to make that very transparent, to householders as well, where the materials is not just going, but what it's been turned into, what is it being recycled into? And I think that's a great story to be told, particularly if we're going to engage with more people to do more recycling. I know that SEPA might have, a particular view on, the actual legality of what happens to waste and, how transparent or otherwise that system is currently. But, it's a bit, I kind of use the analogy of fair trade sometimes. We're very always conscious of, where our coffee comes from and such like, and supermarket and, Britain now only uses fair trade, sells fair trade products. So it's a bit the same. It's got fair waste, as I call it. We really need to understand what the implications of our waste is in Scotland, and we should probably, not just from an environmental point of view, but even from a moral point of view, start to think that, shipping our waste out of the country isn't, possibly helping other countries, other developing countries, with some of the situations that they find themselves in. Obviously exporting opportunities to reprocess that material as well. So there's our economic story to doing much more with that waste here in Scotland, or those resources here in Scotland. You mentioned steel. So yeah, steel is one of the opportunities that we see in the circular economy. We currently export quite a lot of decommissioned steel from the decommissioner of the North Sea. A lot of steel, we don't reprocess steel anymore in Scotland. It's basically cut up and shipped off to other steel manufacturers in other parts of Europe and beyond. But we actually have a demand for steel in our infrastructure going forward, particularly. So that's clearly an opportunity to see how can we potentially use electric arc furnace approach to start reprocessing our own steel here in Scotland, and one, creating jobs, but also in terms of the embedded carbon in that steel, because Scotland has renewable power. It's the third greenest grid in the world. Our steel would be much more advantageous to be used in terms of the climate, rather than shipping in steel from abroad, which potentially has been made in coal fire. So I think there's a massive opportunity for us, both economically and environmentally, to really think about that system. And that goes back to Terry's point about system thinking. Everybody just looks at it in one aspect, but if we looked at the whole steel system for Scotland, how could we create a more circular economy here in terms of the flows of material into and out of and into our infrastructure? I think it just needs a number of parties to come together and make that type of connection, that we've got an opportunity here. We've got a demand for steel going forward in terms of the infrastructure that we require for our net zero between now and 2045. You know, do we need those materials? So why aren't we making use of the materials that we already have in our society? So it's still a great example of what the circular economy could really, how the circular economy could transform, particular material management for economic and social and climate goals.
Thanks for that, Ian. And really interesting to hear about our steel and the manufacture and recycle of our steel as well. I'm keen to know more about it. I'm happy to have a conversation with the committee on that. And I'm sure we all are, because it is really interesting. But it'd be good to know if we have got a case study on that and just what role that we can play in the committee about how we can actually promote that as well.
I'm very happy to share more information about some of the work that we've looked at in terms of steel, and I know there's other parties in Scotland have been looking at this as well, so I'm quite happy to share that either with yourself directly or the committee afterwards.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Colette. Liam Kerr has a supplemental question in this area.
Two supplementals, very briefly, convener, if I may, which arise from that line of questioning. So, Ian Gulland, I'll put these to you. Again, where are you, first of all, with the development of plans to ensure that plastics from the deposit return scheme are ultimately recycled in Scotland rather than being shipped abroad?
So obviously that is under the control of the producers. Now that legislation has been passed, there is obviously a scheme administrator of Circularity Scotland who are now in play, who are putting the implementation plan together. So we are obviously supporting them. They are, as an organisation, very keen to do exactly what you said, have the plastics that are going to be collected through the scheme reprocessed and repurposed here in Scotland back into the supply chain to create both climate and economic opportunities. So we are working directly with them as other parties and government landscape to support the potential for a reprocessing capacity to be built here in Scotland. Obviously, the scheme isn't up and running yet, so we have some time to hopefully land our project.
Thank you. Second question I have is, again, arises from Colette Stevenson's line of questioning. There was a cut in the Scottish Government budget to Zero Waste Scotland of £4 million between 2019-20 and 2020-21. And I've had a brief look at your last accounts. The Scottish Government grant was down by 1.5 million in 2020-21. Presumably, or one would have thought, this would have had potentially quite a significant impact. So the question begged is, what impact has the cut in funding had in your ability to deliver the outcomes that you're trying to?
So the funding cuts are related to ERDF. The match funding that we need for ERDF, and obviously as we start to look towards the end of that, there will be significant impacts in those programmes. I mean, it wouldn't mean, the bulk of the money that we've been supporting from ERDF is, as I said, for circular economy businesses at an early stage of development, supporting individual companies. We've supported over 240 individual companies over the last couple of years. So obviously without that money, you could easily say we're going to have to reduce the amount of businesses we'll support, but there are other parts of government who have access to funding, Green Growth Fund, I think it's called, the Green Jobs Fund. So this is about working in partnership with other parts of government to see whether we can, provide a better interface for some of those businesses and introduce them to other parts of support that's available. We have a healthy pipeline of businesses. Circular economy is obviously now very much a central part of Scotland's ambitions around climate change. We now have a new minister has been appointed to lead on circular economy. Definitely an opportunity to scale up businesses and circular economy strategies at local authority level even. So, obviously funding going forward is something that we're very we obviously have to keep an eye on, but we do recognise the bigger picture in terms of funding that's available to public sector agencies such as ourselves.
Thank you.
If I could just come back, the one thing that the fund has done, obviously, our funding does lever in private sector investment. I don't have the figures in front of me, but it's about, you know, for every pound, another £3 or £4 comes in from the private sector. So, you know, there is a growing appetite from the private sector to support circular economy businesses, and that was one of the aims of the fund, was to kind of almost demonstrate the art of the possible in terms of circular economy, so that private sector investment, whether that was, you know, banks or angel investors or venture funds, would take the circular economy more seriously. And, you know, that is beginning to happen now. So there's also, you know, conversations that my team are having with some of those private sector investors to understand what a follow-on programme, for a better word, would look like. So, and, you know, there's a lot of interest in this space, and hopefully there's a role that we can play to provide interface and early support for businesses into that pipeline.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liam. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. I have questions for Zero Waste Scotland and then for SEPA. Yes, I'll start with Zero Waste Scotland. Ian, according to the latest SEPA data, progress on recycling has slowed and reversed. Under 45% of household waste in Scotland was recycled in 2019, but we're seeing huge variation across the country. East Renfrewshire, at the top of the league table, almost 68% of household waste recycled. South Lanarkshire, where I live, 46%. Glasgow, which is hosting COP26, 25%. And Shetland, only 17%. So my question is, why are we not making more progress on recycling rates in Scotland? And what needs to be done to rapidly improve this?
Without getting into the individual councils, I think one of the other challenges is we might want to ask ourselves, are we measuring the right thing? So obviously those measurements are in tons of materials, and that has been the historical way that we've measured the recycling rate. But whilst, you know, there's incremental increases now in terms of household recycling, the actual carbon intensity of what's been recycled has increased significantly. I think it's about up 17% in the last 2 years, and that is because, again, you know, we've been able to use a world-renowned now carbon metric, which allows you to really look at different recycling opportunities, different materials, and actually target the ones that are much more carbon intensive. So, hence, over the last few years, you know, most councils have proactively engaged around food and plastics recycling, which obviously plastics are not very heavy, but, you know, the intensity of plastic recycling has improved. So by measuring carbon, you know, there has been a great shift in recycling performance, if you measure that, but perhaps not when you mention tons of materials. But yeah, there is obviously difference across different authorities. And again, part of the work that we're involved in, particularly around the route map, is assessing how, you know, we will hit the targets in 2025, but more importantly, looking at best practice or good practice across different authorities and trying to understand why some authorities are performing better than others. Is it housing type? Is it approach? Is it communications? Obviously, you know, the Recycling Improvement Fund that I mentioned, £70 million, is an opportunity for councils to further advance some of those recycling schemes that they already have. You know, our evidence continually shows that, you know, something in the region of 60% of what's in the residual bin could still be recycled through the current infrastructure that we have. So that's not a new infrastructure. That's not going out and creating more bins and boxes. It's looking at the system that we already have in place across Scotland, and food waste is a good example of that in terms of capturing that. We've got good, you know, over 80% of Scotland now has a food waste collection service, but the participation rates are quite low. Quite patchy across Scotland. So there's really quick wins that we could all be doing, both at a local level and a national level, to get behind recycling. And we know from continual engagement with householders that, you know, they see recycling as part of fighting climate change. They want to do something. Some of this is about making it, just getting the messages out there and, you know, re-engaging with some of those parts of Scotland which perhaps are not seeing the same recycling levels as others.
You know, I hear what you're saying about other metrics and other measurements and different ways to benchmark, but there was a national target set to increase household recycling to 60% by 2020. We're way off the mark. So these figures to me are very worrying and in part very embarrassing. So are we measuring the wrong thing entirely? And if so, why did we have those targets in the first place?
So the targets were obviously set, I can't remember when, several, 5 or 6, 7 years ago. So they were set then, and you're right, we are making progress, but not at the rate that we'd like to. And again, the route map work that we are undertaking on behalf of the Scottish Government is setting out, you know, the path to hit the 2025 targets, which is obviously the next one in terms of the recycling rate, and go beyond that and try and assess what the ambitions look like. And whether we've got the right strategies in play, the right policy instruments in play right now, or do we need to think differently about strategies and policies? So a lot of work is quite intensive at this moment in time in terms of that route map to understand exactly how do we get it back on track. I just think the tonnage question comes up a lot, you know, particularly when we look at the kind of macro level, you know, in terms of even waste prevention, you know, in terms of preventing, you know, building materials or materials that are slightly inert, you know, is that where our focus should be, or should our focus be on, you know, some of the more carbon intensive products and materials? And I think we're much more aware of all of that now. I think, you know, I'm not making, you know, trying to single out any particular moment in time, but, you know, we're now much more carbon focused as a nation. You know, we're much more carbon literate. We have much more access to information and detail, even on an ongoing basis, on a real-time basis, to make decisions. And obviously, that's climate change is the focus, and it's, you know, definitely looking at the right thing to do for the climate.
Sure. I'm conscious of time, and I do want to get to SEPA. So, in terms of the wider policy landscape, we are expecting a review from the Scottish Government very soon about the role of large-scale incinerators in Scotland's waste hierarchy. My question, Ian, is should we slam the brakes on new large-scale incinerators being built, and should we have a national moratorium? And what would you like to see in the policy review that will be announced very shortly?
So obviously, we are, as you've got, we are supporting government, will be supporting government with that policy review. We've provided some information already. You know, it's out there about, you know, the climate impacts of incineration, you know, as opposed to landfill. So absolutely, we are aware that, you know, we do need to come up with clarity on this going forward. But, you know, posing of waste, whether it's incineration or landfill, is, as we keep saying, it's part of the old system, it's part of the linear economy. We need to decouple ourselves from that. We need to think more aggressively about how we create different strategies to reduce, reuse and repair and remanufacture our materials. And we need to do it at a much faster rate. We need to do it at a much strategic rate. I think handing it over to individual local authorities, 32 local authorities, you know, we need to have a much more collaborative approach to this as a nation. You know, our waste system, to some extent, is fragmented. You know, it's 32 local authorities doing, you know, a variety of different approaches, with a number of waste management companies in the middle. We're still a small country. We really want to realise some of the ambitions around our resources. I think we need to have much more, you know, collaboration and joined up, you know, approach to how we can harness those resources for economic gain as well as climate gain. So yeah, certainly I look forward to being supporting the review, you know, and to get some clarity as quickly as possible.
Yeah, I think we all want clarity. On that question of new large-scale incinerators, would it be a sign of failure if we see new incinerators being consented and constructed from this point onward, given what we know about climate emergency?
I think the challenge is, as we said, you know, the incineration is not the answer. It's not low carbon. It's not a low carbon solution. It still produces CO2 emissions. We, as a country, are trying to move away from, you know, we're trying to reduce all our CO2 emissions. We've had great success in our energy sector in terms of renewables. you know, what we should be doing now is thinking, you know, how do we get out of incineration? You know, by certainly by 2045, we need to be thinking about what's our exit strategy. Obviously, we still have infrastructure as, you know, currently in play in terms of incinerators, but what's the future plan for this? Because it's, you know, it is a bit like diesel engines on the from the trains. You know, we want to electrify the trains. You know, we've got a plan in place to do that, to wean ourselves off, you know, diesel. By 2045, we realise all our carbon targets, that, you know, waste in the current form will not exist.
That's very helpful, Ian. Thank you for that. Good to get that on the record.
I think our panel are back on.
With a slight technical hitch there, but I'll continue. I think if Terry can hear me. I want to turn to SEPA, because you've been having a hard time. You were the victim of a cyber attack on Christmas Eve, and I want to put on record my thanks to you and your whole team in SEPA for the hard work you've had to do in trying to recover from that. Terry, as Chief Executive, you advised the board of SEPA earlier this year that there may be a risk of not protecting the Scottish environment, especially from key threats. I wonder if you can give us an update and tell us what impact the cyber attack has had on SEPA's regulatory actions or any environmental outcomes that you were working towards.
So the standard board papers have the risks that you express if you don't do what the paper's proposing. So what I was referring to there was, we had a plan from early in the cyber attack. A cyber attack of the nature we've had is very significant, and you can't do everything. So what we did from very early days was make decisions about what were high priority. So the sort of risks we were focusing on that could have happened if we hadn't, I think, made the right choices and if the staff hadn't risen to the challenges would be, that, for example, if we hadn't got the flood warnings and alerts out. Now, we haven't failed to do those. The staff have done an amazing job, including on the day the attack happened. That's a critical service for Scotland. So that has been maintained. Other things in that area, such as information about water scarcity or river levels, we got those up and running pretty quickly. So we focused on the highest priority things, which avoided those sort of risks. In the way we regulate businesses, I think the key thing was the pandemic, in a way, it helped, because the pandemic had meant we couldn't send people out in the field very much. So we had to do two things. We had to work out which businesses and which sectors were the riskiest. And we've got good knowledge over many years of which businesses and sectors have a good track record, to be blunt, which ones we can trust the most. We made that very clear to businesses in a philosophy statement, which we published. We wanted them and expected them to do the right thing. We would support them to do that because they face challenges with the pandemic, but we would be there if people abuse that trust. So that put us in a place when the cyber attack hit. So we sort of got this double whammy of, we were already used to saying, we know these, we had a list of a number of sites that cause things like odour and noise, which are terrible for local residents, even worse during lockdown conditions because people are living at home. So we focused our limited ability to get out in the field to deal with those sites, as well as the high hazard sites and sectors that probably there were people taking advantage. So in broadly in the waste sector, we saw an increase in fly tipping. So working with councils and others, police, we put an effort into those areas. So I think the important thing we did, and we will report on this later in the year, is how did we take those risks and our extensive knowledge of the industries we regulate and work to prioritise those things that were riskiest? Now, I can't say that here's the data that shows that that worked, you know, as a 9 out of 10, et cetera, but I can say to the committee with, I think, a fair degree of confidence that we were able to focus on those areas of highest risk, make sure things were in place so that environmental harm wasn't prevalent, because we were constrained first by the pandemic and then second by the cyber attack. The final point I'd make is, what we need to do is take the lessons from both the pandemic and the cyber attack, because we found new ways of achieving, making sure people complied and stuck with the law, and really build them in to our new model of working, because we were going through change anyway. We think we've got an ambitious regulatory change agenda that we had started before the pandemic, if we can take the, I guess, the workarounds that we've had to use with both the pandemic and the cyber attack, build them into all the good things we used to do, we think we'll be able to more strongly tackle the risks that you quoted me referring to in our in my report to the board.
Thank you for that, Terry. Thanks. Just very, very briefly.
Can that be brief, please?
Police Scotland has said that we know criminals will exploit any opportunity for their own gain, and COP26 will be no different. The Scottish Business Resilience Centre is advising businesses ahead of COP26 to take steps to protect themselves physically and online. As part of these national discussions about resilience, is CPAT around the table giving that advice so that we are learning these lessons and applying them very, very quickly ahead of COP26?
In terms of cyber?
In terms of cyber security, yes.
Yeah, so two things quickly. I commissioned independent reviews of various parts of our cyber attack. Now, some of those need to be kept confidential because they're about the criminal investigation, and also we don't want to give away improvements we're making to our own cyber security to cyber criminals, and we also need to protect privacy. But we will be publishing at some point in the next month or two a lot of material from those reviews, which we don't need to keep confidential, and we've got them styled a fair bit. We've had to redact, you know, a fair bit because of those reasons I outlined. But what we're being told is that these independent reviews, the way we've been transparent and public, is probably by global standards leading edge. Most organisations that have a cyber attack don't talk much about it. But we'll publish those reviews. We're working with Scottish Government to make sure the lessons are learned, and the Scottish Business Resilience Centre. I've also been giving briefings to series of chief executives and IT executives throughout the public sector. I do a sort of standard one-hour talk to explain to them what happened with our attack to the extent I can, given those constraints, and the sort of lessons, both what you can do to protect yourself further from an attack, and if unfortunately it does get through, what are the lessons we've got about how to cope if an attack happens.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Mark Rustle, please.
Yeah, thanks. I wanted to ask you, all three of you actually, about the changing remit of your organisations. I mean, Nick Halfhide, you talked earlier on about the need to really scale up to tackle the nature emergency. And I think I noticed in your comments that you're now taking on responsibility for marine protected area designation, I think. Is that right, from Marine Scotland? So I'm interested in understanding kind of how you see your bodies developing going forward, what changes in terms of your remit that you're going to be hopefully making, and how you're going to be developing more partnership working as well. So could I start with Nick, please?
Yes, thanks very much for that question. Technically, our remit hasn't changed on marine protected areas, just to be clear. It's a role we've always been playing in terms of giving advice to Marine Scotland and to ministers. But more generally, what we see is that we need to scale up the level of engagement that we've already been undertaking, but realising that it's simply just not enough. So we need to further the number of people, whether it's businesses or communities or organisations we engage with, and do it more deeply. Making sure, on the one hand, that our expertise and the massive amounts of data and evidence that we have is more available. And also having a leadership role, I think, in saying to people, let's stop doing so much talking about this. What is the action that we need to do? So, and that's true whether we're talking in the uplands, whether we're talking within the agricultural sector or in the cities. How can we lead the change with the evidence and the skills we've got to make the real difference happen? Because we know that the scale and pace of our activities needs to increase very significantly, both to meet the nature crisis, but also obviously the contribution that makes to the climate change crisis.
What does that look like? Increased regional land use partnerships, you know, what are the actual actions that are going to be needed on the ground to drive that?
So I missed the start of that question, but I'm assuming you're saying what do we need to do more
in terms of
the
regional
ground?
Land use partnerships in particular?
Yeah. So the regional land use partnerships, I understand, will be led by local authorities. So part of our role is to help them move into this field, which is one that they're not so familiar with. But making sure that we're at the table with our evidence and our expertise, corralling, if we need to, all of the other partners, but also to leading what that might mean. So from a biodiversity perspective, I think it will be much clearer, being much clearer what needs to be happened within that particular land use partnership in terms of ensuring that we've identified which species we might need to target or which particular habitats, what a local nature network can really look like within that space, and then how we can bring in both the kind of the other partners around the table, but also private finance where necessary, alongside public sector funding and any other money that's available to actually make it happen, and all the time making sure that the communities who will be most getting the benefit but the impact from this are as engaged as possible. So it not only meets the needs of nature, but also the needs of those local communities, for example, places that they might go out and enjoy nature for their mental and physical health, but also how it affects, for example, water supply, so that we try and integrate all of the benefits that restoring nature at a local level can bring.
So can I ask Terry Hearn about changing remits as well then? I mean, we had evidence in the Just Transition Commission several weeks ago in committee. It's clear that there's now going to be a need for high energy users to produce just transition plans. What will SEPA's remit be in relation to that? Is that an area that you're already working on in terms of your sustainable growth agreements or what?
So if you look at the setting, the scientists say by 2030 we have to have made huge inroads into decarbonising and dematerialising our economies and societies around the world. I think SEPA will largely use the same sort of programs and tools. We've now got a broader set of them. What we will do is change the nature of what we do in line with what you just suggested. So I would have a philosophy of, if we have to make these huge inroads in changing the Scottish society and economy, we will have to have very low tolerance for people who can't even meet minimum standards. Now, that doesn't mean throwing the book at everyone. Some people just need help and they can quickly get there. But if people are deliberately breaking the law, then they need to find regulation painful, expensive and uncomfortable. And we need to get better and tougher at that. We've started that. We've set up an enforcement team. That's a key plank. The vast majority of people don't need that. There are some who do. Some, even really good performers, need it some of the time when they have a mistake, etc. What we will try and do with our remit is get into, with businesses where we regulate, get into their boardrooms, get into their executive rooms, talk to the owners of businesses, because that's where the big decisions are made about what sort of products you produce, how you fundamentally change what you do. Now, that will be sometimes through a sustainable growth agreement. With the Scotch Whisky Association, I talk about them a fair bit. They've got a sectoral plan, so we will try and fit in with what they're trying to do and use our tools to help them decarbonise and dematerialise, as I talked about earlier, similarly with the Farmers Union. But the range of sustainable growth agreements we develop will be a key for that. We will develop more. The other thing I would say we would do is, when we're talking about people's ambitions, so I use the Grangemouth example, we need to sit down with the players and say, what are the set of challenges? So if people want support from us as a regulator to decarbonise, we will also put on the table, you've got two residual compliance issues. Fix those quickly. Get on with it. Stop the local pollution. And then we will, at the same time, we haven't got time to do one and then the other. And people who are local shouldn't be putting up with local pollution because we're dealing with the big issues. We have to do both at the same time. This is where we need to be in at the top of organisations. I think that's a lot of the change you'll see from us in our remit. Most of the history of environment protection is experts, which we still need and will play a key role in the regulatory body, working with an environment manager or plant people. We still need to do that. They're critical because they'll know the technical issues and have some good ideas. But we absolutely must be talking to the people who run the businesses, because they will make the big decisions about what to produce and how to produce.
I mean, that's regulation, but that's not just transition, is it? Because a just transition isn't just about the boardroom, it's about the workers and the communities as well and planning that transition. So, I mean, are you working in that space of just transition, or are you still applying the regulatory limits, you know, enforcing where appropriate?
Yes, absolutely what I just described. And you're also correct in saying, as you'll have seen in the Leaven program we've done, where the Sustainable Growth Agreement, yes, has some businesses involved. It has more community groups, NGOs, the local college, the local council. So fundamentally, yes, it will involve a whole range of partners. I tend to focus on the business community when I answer those questions, because that's our primary into those sort of processes, and it's what people demand of us. But you're quite right. We have expanded significantly how we will work with all parts of a broad community, including the business community. The mechanism for us getting involved in those things will tend to be our role as a regulator, and then we will play, through that, we will play a broader role in terms of a just transition, as you suggested.
Okay, and then Ian, final question, same question really to you in terms of remit. I mean, obviously you provide key advice for government and local authorities. Absolutely welcome your work over a long period of time on incineration as well, and getting to grips with the environmental impact of that. So that remit will remain. But how do you see the work of Zero Waste Scotland developing over time, particularly in the context of the Circular Economy Bill that's coming?
Yeah, and I probably alluded to it. I mean, we are certainly changing as a business. We launched a new corporate plan in 2019, which really recognising that our demand for our services was increasing, particularly from businesses, but also from communities and individual citizens. And, you know, and obviously we were much more aware of the areas that we needed to work in if we were going to have the highest impact. And these potentially weren't the areas we were previously working in. So we did recognise that our business needed to evolve, which were still underway. Obviously, COVID has had an impact on that, but we recognise that, as I say, it's working in partnership with others. So, you know, our success with Chambers of Commerce to further circular economy strategies and business opportunities at a local level has been really something we've built on. And we're keen to build on again. You know, we've been working with HIE on a similar approach, and potentially working the offering with South of Scotland as well. So we know there's more people, as I said, kind of at our door. So it's how do we empower and upskill other parts of either the public landscape or, you know, sectors, you know, trade associations to provide that level of support and spot those opportunities. But yeah, working with communities is something that we're getting much more involved in, and even at individual citizens directly, but also universities and colleges, getting them to help us with some of the further research and analysis that we need, you know, because even some of the sectors we're moving into, particularly, you know, renewables, looking at circular economy opportunities there are new ground for all of us. And again, it's harnessing the expertise which is in other parts of Scotland. So again, that's that partnership working. And, you know, a bit like Terry, you know, a lot our work has really shifted because, you know, a lot of the interface we had with individual businesses was at the back door, looking at pins, and, you know, environmental officers looking at, you know, changing light bulbs or whatever, you know, some sort of low-level stuff. So now it's the circular economy is at boardroom level. So again, as a business, we are, you know, having to have those types of conversations. And some of it is very welcomed, obviously. Businesses looking to kind of pivot within the current, you know, looking at resilience in terms of supply chains, looking at, you know, consumer pressures or supply chain pressures, you know, to be much more focused on the circular economy. But other areas, you know, are quite come on the journey yet, you know, even individual businesses. So there's still work to be done, but that needs to be done at boardroom level. And there's clear signals coming down, you know, about future investment, you know, future investors looking for, you know, more net zero approaches or visibility of net zero approaches and businesses going to secure investment. So trying to get ahead of that to, you know, not just paint the bleak picture around circular economy or climate change, but there's massive opportunities, massive economic opportunities for businesses here in Scotland to be ahead of the game, not just for the Scottish supply chain, but, you know, for export as well, because I keep saying, you know, we have, you know, the third greenest grid in the world. So products and materials that are processed and refurbished here in Scotland are going to be attractive to others across the world. So there is a huge economic gain to be had, as well as the clear climate gain, which is what really underpins all of this.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you much, Mark. That brings us to the end of our allotted time and concludes this evidence session. Let me once again thank our panel members for joining us this morning and for providing your evidence across a very wide range of issues. Enjoy the rest of your day. The committee will now move into private session. Thank you.